Hello, I'm Jonathan Ross, and it will come as a shock to absolutely no one that I love toys. That's because toys fire our children's imaginations. They provide grown-ups with wonderful memories of a fun-filled innocence, but mainly because if you've got someone like this on your side, he'll keep you safe from alien invasion. Check this out. Feel safer now, don't you? Wow, it's like I've died and gone to toy heaven, which tonight is where I'm taking you with our Christmas countdown of the all-time greatest toys. Over the next 3 hours, we'll be unashamedly wallowing in nostalgia, looking at the toys we've loved and the toys that have inspired us.
Basically, I eat like pasta.
Loving it.
Everyone has had a go at it.
As we count down from 100 to 1, we'll be telling the stories behind the toys.
And it was great fun. At least it appeared like that in the ad.
Actually brimming, that's really embarrassing.
I remember It kind of made me feel quite smart.
But above all, we'll be revelling in the sheer, unbridled joy of the toys that were once your whole world, before pesky mortgages got in the way.
It's the coolest thing, man.
From board games to building blocks, boys' toys to girls' toys, through fads and crazes.
It's not going happy.
All the way through to your favourite teddy bears. This is one toy story which is sure to capture the anticipation of the night before Christmas. If it were up to me, we'd be counting the greatest toys to infinity and beyond, but that would take forever. So we've drawn up a shortlist of 100 and asked you, the great British public, with both a poll and an online vote, to choose your favourites and rank them in order of awesomeness. So let's begin with number 100, and only a nation of maniacs would make us start the show with anything other than a pair of boxing robots.
Bonkers.
The game you voted in at number 100 first entered the ring back in 1965. Yes, decades before video games, it was these boxing robots that were filling us with wonder and making our thumbs sore.
You're slugging it out in the middle of the ring! And there's a hard drive to the jaw! And Blue Bomber's block is knocked off!
His block is knocked off?
Sure, but you can press it right back on again. When you press this plunger, he throws a right uppercut. Press the other plunger and there's a left jab.
The Blue Bomber's looking for an opening, and there it is. That's the end of round two.
The game's heavyweight plastic design also helped to knock the stuffing out of traditional cloth and wooden toys and heralded a new dawn in toy making.
Boy, this is the greatest!
Over 30 years later, another new dawn arose. The year was 1997, and the most successful toy launch in history aimed at the under fours was about to say, eh-oh.
You can't make a children's television programme these days unless you have toys. You know, it isn't a question of have the idea to have toys. I mean, you've got to have toys or you can't raise enough money to make a programme.
And so it was that the shenanigans of Tinky Winky, Dipsy, La La and Po appeared not only on our TV screens, but on Christmas wish lists across the country.
Teletubbies!
Say hello!
Teletubbies have got people camping out in shop doorways. These were the scenes at one store on Teesside at the early hours of this morning, as people began queuing for their own little doll.
You've been waiting the longest, since when?
10 to 11 last night.
Why?
Because I want a Teletubby.
I was horrified by the demand, to be honest. I mean, it was just so awful that people felt that Christmas wouldn't work if they didn't get a Teletubby doll. You know, I just couldn't take it in. It was frightening.
The shortage of Teletubbies has led to some of the toys selling on the black market for up to £100.
Was it worth the wait?
It was, definitely. For Tinky Winky, it'd do anything.
For Tinky Winky. Yeah.
With demand reaching feverish levels across Britain, there was only one place left in the country to locate a Teletubby.
We both had people approaching us who wanted us to get toys for them because they couldn't get them in the shops. And I remember
my husband stole mine and gave it to Shirley Bassey. I've never forgiven him. I've never forgiven him.
At number 98, you voted in nothing more than a simple rag doll called Holly Hobby.
It's cute. It's like from Little House on the Prairie, where they have like a bonnet and an apron. She's soft and completely covered head to toe in clothes.
But Holly is not all she seems. It isn't just TV which can spawn best-selling toys. Holly actually started life back in 1969 as a picture on a greeting card.
This is what I would give to a child of mine. I would not give her a Barbie, a pointy plastic Barbie. I'd give her one of these, because it's cute.
And number 97 from the year 2005, it's the second TV-inspired toy range on your list so far, courtesy of a fearless, super-powered young hero named... But for anybody over the age of 10, just who is Ben 10?
Ben 10 is a young boy who tries to fight crime and has a watch on his wrist, and he can change the dial to 10 different positions and he can change into different aliens.
Then he battles, I think primarily against a character called Vilgax.
I have come too far to be denied.
And he wins. But he doesn't win so that Vilgax dies, he wins so that Vilgax fades into some place going, I'll be back.
What would Ben do with his Omnitrix FX? And soon kids everywhere could be Ben 10 with this watch and these action figures.
Heat Blast with oozing slime bubbles. 10 aliens to pick from.
I mean, it is marketing gone mad, isn't it, Ben 10? The fact that you can buy a Ben 10 watch, which actually does nothing, include tell the time.
The Ben 10 Alien Laboratory is loaded with alien action. Transform alien rocks. No way.
There's a Ben 10 camper van style motorhome thing. I mean, it's good to see the caravanning community represented in something that kids think are cool.
Now, I'll admit that Ben 10 does look the business, but if you want to talk about sci-fi action figures, you can't beat this next toy from 1966.
Meet Major Matt Mason, the bravest astronaut yet.
And who better to tell you about this guy than his biggest fan ever, and that's me! Now, this is my favourite action figure and probably my favourite toy of all time. He is Major Matt Mason, Mattel's man in space. When I was about 8 or 9 and wondering what I'd find in my Christmas stocking after Santa had been, well, this was the one thing I desperately wanted to discover there. It was the time of the space race, the moon landings, and this fella, Major Matt Mason, well, he was our way of getting on the act. But he wasn't alone in his mission to conquer space, oh no. Say hello to some of Matt's buddies. You've got Sergeant Storm, there's civvy astronaut Doug Davis, and way ahead of his time, Lieutenant Jeff Long here, who was the first African-American in space, nearly 40 years ago. Come back. That's why I love Major Matt Mason. Brave, ahead of his time, and with little legs that flop around and all this kind of equipment like this. Look at that. It's no wonder that I've spent hours and hours and hours playing with him this week. From a toy for the more mature boy to the latest toy for a totally new sort of girl.
Baby, can't you see I'm calling?
Way back in 2001, the toy industry discovered a completely new type of person. They were called tweens, girls aged between 8 and 14, who were too old for silly kids' toys and too young for yucky boys. Brittany and Christina were their totally awesome role models, so the best thing for girls at this difficult age was to sell them these things.
Meet the Bratz, Yasmin, Chloe, Sasha and Jade. Got a passion for fashion. Each of the Bratz comes with two really wild mix-and-match outfits. So don't theorize, accessorize.
And this way, little girls could annoy their parents as well, as people howled in horror at the seemingly risque nature of these little dollies.
Someone being like, oh, I want to be like Barbie, I suppose it's not the best life choice, but better than I want to be like Bratz. Loads of makeup, massive hair, short skirts.
Would the profession be of a doll like this?
Oh, that's probably Britney Spears, I should imagine.
Britney Spears.
That's their aspiration.
Let's have a look at some other ones. So this is Britney Spears. And where would this doll work, do you think? Well, is this a hotel lobby Bratz or...?
Parents may have been outraged, but kids, they saw something altogether more fun.
Fun to play with, and they're weird because like their feet come off, not just their shoes, their whole feet with like the stub on the end, and you can break them and stuff. I just really like them.
At number 94, you voted in another toy that flew off the shelves.
I'm enjoying it now. It's got a bit windy. It's a bit better.
Now pull right, Nicholas. Now she's looping to the right. Pull left.
A former bus driver from the West Country, Peter Powell took the simple 3,000-year-old kite and did something no one had done before. He added a second string, transforming it into something you could actually steer.
It is a knack, and it is like flying an aeroplane, by the way. If you were a pilot, you would know the controls work exactly the same. Silly as that.
right for right, left for left.
As with all great ideas, the beauty of this toy lay in its simplicity.
All you have to do is open the kite and pop in the cross strut, you've got that, and it's ready to fly.
Peter's twin-handle kite innovation landed him the Inventor of the Year award, and in 1976, things really took off.
That was when I won the Toy of the Year award. The runner-up then was Lego. The little lad from the Cotswolds nipped in and grabbed the award.
The massive sales of the kite brought not only fame, but also the beginnings of a fortune. Then, the dream turned sour.
I think we can establish at least three deaths for cause by my kite. This is on hilltops where people were running back to create a bit of wind and, of course, over the edge of the cliff.
With this British kite not quite being a symbol for safety and with Peter's design being modified and sold cheaper by other manufacturers, the kite dream was over.
Gradually, it just died a natural death and it caused me quite an heartache in the sense. So all my jigs went, all my patterns, and my scrapbooks with everything about what I'd done. I'm afraid I had one huge bonfire. I think in life, though, myself, unless you know what it's like to be successful and then lose, you haven't really lived. When I go on to the beach, just what I do see, of course, it brings a little bit of joy. I'll hear people being dragged up and down with these boards on the water, pulling left and right. It was the two-line principle. They'll always say, well, Peter Powell invented that, you know.
At 93, a little doll with big ideas. By the 70s, Britain was slowly becoming the culturally diverse country we know and love today, and it hadn't escaped the notice of those clever toy manufacturers. Here's Pipper and friends, they're setting the track. So in 1972, Palatoy released Pippa, the original cool chick, who along with her mates could now enjoy multi-ethnic Chinese tea parties.
This was my Pippa doll, and I think we called her Marie, after Marie Osmond. And I think, as well, she was subject to a haircut. All of my dolls had haircuts.
Pretty Pippa's got lots of things to do and lots of friends. Here's Mandy and Penny too.
I dressed her up as an Elizabethan. I liked her to be the queen, even though she was quite small, because I used to play queens and court. Yeah, I was on my own there. Even my own family wouldn't join me in that game. The fun never ends with Pipper and
friends. At number 92, it's the first football game on your countdown.
Striker was the new improved Sabutio. Pushed him on the head, the foot kicked the ball, which is much more like the kicking action of a footballer. Loved it.
Striker first appeared on the toy team sheet in 1972, and very soon it became Super Striker, and it's just like real football. Honest.
For real football action, there's only one Super Striker.
And so, from the beautiful game to number 91, and what looks a little like spinning tops on steroids.
Beyblades are like modern-day spinning tops that spin and crash into each other. After a series of knockouts, the one left standing is the winner.
I can remember being in primary school using these, and everyone thought that it was going to become a new Olympic sport, and it was going to be one of those things that was just going to take off.
And there's a good reason to win the competition, a whopping $1 million prize.
It did take off for quite a while, but then I think it kind of dropped off the scene a little bit, but it's definitely one of my favourite toys that I can remember from primary school.
So we've been down with the girls and up to the skies, and we've only reached number 91. Join us after the break, when we'll be back with more toys and a Lapland Argos, including the decapitated head that is Girls' World, and the single greatest thing in the whole of history ever, and I'm not even exaggerating.
Johnny 7, OMA, the one-man army by Topper.
As he moved the dial, he went like this.
It turned me into briefly a code breaker for 6 years for MI5.
Welcome back to 100 Greatest Toys. You know, people often say the greatest gift you can give to another human being is the gift of love. And to those people I say, you've obviously never seen the Johnny 7 one-man army machine gun. I'm not his only fan. Former SAS hard man and best-selling writer Andy McNab loves it too. He asked us to conceal his identity for his own protection, but if he had a Johnny 7 one-man army machine gun, he wouldn't need protection.
Squad is ready.
It may be 46 years old, but those who can remember that far back have cast their vote, making the Johnny 7 one-man army number 90 on our one down. Take a look at what it can do.
Grenade launcher, 2 anti-armor gun, 3 anti-tank gun, 4 bullet-firing rifle, 5 Tommy gun, 6 anti-bunker gun, 7 cap-firing pistol. There's no other gun like it.
When I was about 7, the toy to have was the Johnny 7 machine gun, and it was, you know, the Christmas one. Everybody wanted it. And it done everything. But Mum and Dad couldn't afford one.
Well, guess what? Merry Christmas, Andy McNab.
Oh, it is as well. It's a real one, isn't it? Here we go.
Look at that.
When I finally got one, my dad came in, he said, look, I've cracked it. I managed to buy one. But what he didn't tell me, it was second-hand, and this bit was missing, the pistol. But it didn't matter, because basically I had it, and it was just about really just nicking someone's pistol grip and putting it on. They'll never know. Basically, it was all about trying to zap somebody with any of the missiles that was coming out. And basically, if you got zapped, that was it. You was out of the game. And these games went on for weeks, you know. And with this, loads of buttons, loads of springs. You can holler, shout, take it out in the rain, do what you want. Great bit of kit.
And from that lethal weapon to this lethal toy. There now follows a public information film on the dangers of banging your balls together.
These are called clackers. And they call that because they clack.
It didn't creep up on us. It was like there were no clackers, no one ever knew what they were, and then everybody had them.
The early 1970s was the time when children could be entranced by toys gleefully simple as two plastic balls on the end of a piece of string.
The clackers is a good name because it's kind of onomatopoeic, isn't it? It sounds like what they do.
It's not going happy, 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 happy.
But hold on, those balls were dangerous.
Nowadays you can't walk down any street without hearing this noise.
And they're clackers, and although they're great fun, they've turned out to be extremely dangerous toys.
I remember clackers were confiscated at our school, presumably because they were dangerous. I mean, yeah, I get that.
They've given people broken arms and sprained wrists, and even worse, the plastic balls have even been known to shatter and damage people's eyes. And if you're still not convinced that they are dangerous, have a look at this.
That was too good to be true, that something so simple could be so much fun. So in stepped the health and safety police.
The next thing to find out was whether the clacker balls could withstand the impact of smashing into each other over and over again. They did this by dropping a 5-pound weight onto the balls from a height of 4 feet. But with so many of the balls disintegrating and flying about the room, this test turned out to be rather dangerous for the technicians.
And it's rather a pity that such a good idea for a toy has turned out to be so dangerous. I don't think we'll be seeing clackers around very much in the future.
And that's the end of that. But it just came and it was gone. Maybe in a matter of weeks.
And so, from banging balls, we go to tumbling dice.
Pop-a-matic pops the dice, pop a six and you move twice.
In the mid-1960s came an innovation that would ensure dice would never again be lost underneath the sofa, as a series of Pop-O-Matic games were released with this revolutionary feature. And despite being voted for by you, some toy Luddites remain unconvinced.
Why did they design that? What was the point? Were people losing dye, you know, all over the world and thinking, we must find a device to contain this dye?
That's Pop-O-Matic trouble. Watch the dice in the plastic bubble. It pops you in and out of trouble. Here comes sister. Look out, Jack. You've got trouble. You go back.
I preferred throwing the dice. It felt more like you were casting your own luck, you know, instead of this stupid little bubble that you didn't even touch the dye.
With the return to our screens of Doctor Who in the mid-noughties came a toy that allowed kids everywhere to get to play the bad guy. Yikes!
Join the Cyberman army with the Doctor Who voice changer helmet with Cyberman phrases. And frightening sound effects.
This toy is...
I am Unit 5
of 8 9 H. And it's... I am Cyberman. Once I was human. It's, It's, I really like it because, it's really a good toy because, like, you put it on and it changes the voice.
Thank you.
See?
Change your voice to Cyberform with the built-in synthesizer.
Resistance is illogical.
I think it's quite strange, actually, like, the design. Like, I never really remembered them having brains.
How dare you.
At last, what the world was waiting for, a magnetic drawing toy.
With Magnadoodle, you can make your googly eyes.
When I was a kid, pen and paper were enough. And Magnadoodle is but the first alliance with the world of art in your countdown of great toys. But thankfully, with Magnadoodle's wipe-down surface, you don't have to put the kids' work on your fridge.
Complete with three Magnadoodle markers. It's ideal.
Many people say to me, Jonathan, now that you're over 30, how do you stay so lithe, supple and athletic? And I tell them the secret is simple. I don't. Frankly, it takes me 20 minutes to get out of a chair these days. But if I was a toy, I could use this. Corn syrup. It certainly worked for this guy. At number 85, it's your flexible friend.
It's Stretch Armstrong!
That's right, it's Stretch Armstrong, the almost indestructible toy that could put up with any amount of abuse at the hands of hyperactive kids everywhere.
We had bunk beds, and my sister would sit on the top bunk, and then we'd tie him up between our bunks and then pretend that we was playing him, like, we was playing a guitar. Pointless, but brilliant.
But behind the 1970s laughter, was there a deadly secret?
I stretched at it so much that I bust it, but I remember the rumour around at school was, if that liquid that comes out gets on your skin, it burns you.
I think it was one of the great classroom myths about Stretch Armstrong, that somehow inside him was this carcinogenic fluid that allowed him to stretch so far. In actual fact, it was just a combination of latex and corn syrup.
At number 84, the toy you had to get your hands on.
It's Tickle Me Elmo. Retail price £15, market value much, much more. A serious shortage of Elmo dolls. This year's craze has turned some grown-ups into children.
Based on the Sesame Street character of the same name, Tickle Me Elmo unleashed a wave of frankly juvenile behaviour from grown-ups across the world on its release in 1996.
The phenomenon was nobody could get it anymore, that there was no supply. And a lot of people think that toy companies do that on purpose, and it's totally ridiculous. You don't do that on purpose. You want to sell as much as you can. It's like to artificially create some demand. Nonsense. What happened is that they didn't have enough.
The elves are making them as fast as they can, but from what I understand, they just have more children asking for them than have time to make them.
Simple as that. And that turned out to be a positive thing from a PR point of view, because what happened is that, you know, you couldn't get it.
They've queued for it for hours on end, raced for it on hands and knees, and ultimately come to blows.
I grabbed it, and as I was taking it to me, another lady tore it out of my hands. It's ripped.
Psychologists explain that parents behaving like this are fulfilling a need to prove how special they are to their offspring.
They're gone. They're gone.
In the meantime, the manufacturers expect to make profits of £20 million.
What two things make a game truly great?
Crossfire, the only game as exciting as its name.
Crossfire was one of the best games ever invented. Reason being, it combined guns and football.
You've got to be good to score a goal.
Yeah, he's right, you know. Guns, football.
Real steel ammo that hits the puck.
Guns,
that makes Crossfire
football.
The name of the game.
Guns, football.
And you've got to be fast to reload in seconds, to score and win.
You've got to reload, you've got to fire. It was just such a brilliant game. It was, I can't tell you, it was inspired.
It's tough, it's exciting, and it's the only game called Crossfire. Ask for it by name. Crossfire, it's ideal.
The next toy you voted for is a severed head in a box.
Girls World, the exciting new way to learn hair and beauty secrets.
Back in the late 70s, there was Girls World, the toy head that allowed pre-teens a glimpse of impending adulthood by learning to put on makeup. What a lovely idea.
It was a dream toy because you could just do anything to it, because I was never allowed to use makeup on me or my sister, but I could use all the makeup in the world on this head. And it just ended up looking ridiculous.
Yes, it seemed that in the hands of pre-teen girls, poor Girls World became a victim, and that was half the fun.
Lipstick just kind of goes somewhere kind of around the mouth.
You know, I used to put nail varnish on the cheeks and you never get it off. You know, it was the right state, but it was fun.
Often these eyeshadows didn't come out that well. I kind of like went slightly too pale. That's quite, she looks quite stylish then, doesn't she? So I would then get frustrated, like any seven-year-old. So I would have probably gone to my felt tip box at this point.
And occasionally, what you could do, if you felt like it, which we used to sometimes do, is put your head down in a coat, OK, imagine, and then you put that like that, and then you put the collar of the coat like that, so you could actually button up and pretend to be Girls World as well and do a voice and everything. So you could sort of go, oh, hello, my name's Penelope, or hi, I'm Christabel.
Next is the future of music in a box.
At the time, we were running a film sound studio with two brothers, Bert and Ted Coleman, and myself. Things were not going all that well. And we were talking about what we could do, and somebody said, toys. So I said, how about an electronic organ? And I thought, yeah. And I closed my eyes. I said, well, if we extended the circuit board and made it into a sort of keyboard, you could have a stylus and you could play it. We could shove it in a little cabinet and, you know, and I opened my eyes and Bert was staring at me and he said, don't just stand there, don't just sit there, go and make the bloody thing.
Within 3 hours, Brian had whipped up a prototype, and within weeks, he'd perfected the toy that we know and love as the stylophone. With the help of musical pioneer Rolf Harris, though, this plastic box became more than a toy.
It was portable, and it's that kind of buzzy, yet rich kind of analogue sound. It's very simple.
And it's not only Orbital that have been turned on to the wonders of stylophone. Over the last 40 years, a range of artists have looked to the stylophone when they want to get creative.
It's like a little notebook for musicians. You know, you stick it in your pocket and if you have an idea for a tune, you get it out and you're away.
A space oddity, David Bowie, is my favourite use of the stylophone in a piece of music.
Have you got one too?
I don't only have one, I've got one with a special holster.
Ground control to Major Tom.
This is ground control to Major Tom. You've really made the grade.
Would you call a stylophone a toy? No, not really. I think it's, you know, I think it's been used in enough sort of professional recordings to have validated itself as a proper instrument.
The toys you voted for at number 80 are so ugly, not even their mums could love them. In folklore, a troll is a big, bad-tempered, dim-witted beast that lives in a cave. In toy folklore, however, they are colourful, strange-looking plastic dolls that have been infesting kids' bedrooms since 1959, when a Danish fisherman first invented them.
Trolls look different. But they're also, you can also kind of identify them as being part of the human species.
Half mythical creature, half baby.
I just really love trolls. They're just so weird looking.
I found them really creepy. I didn't like them. I didn't want them in the house.
And they really creep me out. I just think their noses are really weird.
Mm-hmm.
I'm Willy Weeble.
In 1971, these egg-shaped lumps of plastic delighted children all over the world. And why wouldn't they? Look, they wobble, but they don't fall down.
Oh, look, Granny, they wobble just like us. Let's go, everybody. Oh, where's Wendy gone? Perhaps she's gone.
However, by 1981, the kids had turned their backs on the Weebles, leaving a ruthless businessman with an easy decision to make.
Weebles. Weebles wobble, but
they don't fall down. The tagline, Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down, was a tagline known by every kid. But Weebles were really wobbling, and they were really, really dying, and somebody needed to put them out of their misery. And so I was the guy who actually killed Weebles back in the early 80s. Oh, Weebles wobble, wobble.
Don't fall down. However, in 2005, a techno vocoder inspired jingle has seen the Weebles bounce back, filling a new generation of preschool kids. Hooray! Yes, Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down. A bit like Anne Widdecombe on Strictly Come Dancing. See you after the break, where I'll be explaining the facts of life. Don't worry, Mum and Dad, not really. So far on our rundown of the 100 greatest toys, we've seen exploding balls, hysterical bears, disembodied dolls' heads, and a one-man army of a toy. Still to come, though, are the remaining 78 toys that you voted for, with everything from a doll that wets itself, some furry spies, and the strongest toy in the world.
You're watching the 100 greatest toys. See you after the break.
Welcome back to our countdown of the 100 greatest toys. So, when a mummy and a daddy love each other very much and they want to have a baby, what they do is they go to a toy shop and they fight the other mummy and daddies for the last Cabbage Patch Kid.
Dr. Loggins, Dr. Loggins, report to delivery staff. We have a mother cabbage in labor.
It's a baby girl.
As a child, I was told I came from a Cabbage Patch. I was born in a Cabbage Patch.
In the late 70s, art student Xavier Roberts was busy studying soft sculptures. The resulting experiments were to become one of the toy sensations of the 1980s. Initially, though, you couldn't buy one for love nor money.
I was in an art show, and everybody kept saying, "How much are they? How much are they?" And I said, "They're not for sale."
But soon, Xavier had a change of heart and allowed his creations to be adopted. Of course, some money had to change hands.
I solemnly promise
to be an understanding parent,
to become an understanding parent.
From the get-go, Xavier Roberts was a pretty shrewd marketer. All his workers would wear gowns like it was a hospital.
The hospital was actually a hospital in the very beginning. It was actually a clinic that was used in the 30s.
Here's a prescription for the baby for TLC, which is Tender Loving Care.
I have three that I've adopted, and they have parties and go places just the same as you and I would.
Baby. So far, so tasteful, but things were about to take an unsavory turn.
Now, in America, there have been near riots. In Britain, people have queued all night, not for the bargain mink coat or the cooker, but for one of these, the famous, now famous, Cabbage Patch doll.
Well, I was actually in Miami in a hotel room just flipping the television, and it was incredible to see all these people running. I was going, what are they running toward? And they were Cabbage Patch kids, and it just like, it was, I thought I was dreaming. I didn't think it was real. It was very surreal.
Yeah, I got the ones I wanted, too. It's crazy in there, yeah. They trampled everybody.
Amazing story. Fern, can you explain it? I could get a lot of money for this on the black market, it appears.
Don't even go there, Frank. 30 years later, though, and the Cabbage Patch madness continues. And if you're feeling brave, you can even visit the new Babyland General.
Well, I have a portrait of Xavier, the mother cabbage. It's pretty awesome.
We got our first Cabbage Patch Kid in 1983.
It's this one right here.
Then very soon, we found CJ.
Coleman, Justin, CJ.
If you added up all the population of Cabbage Patch Kids, they're somewhere in between Japan and Mexico. Around 122 million worldwide have we found homes for.
Next, repeat after me. Simon says, eh-oh-ah-eh-oh.
This is the most amazing computer game you've ever seen. He's called Simon.
And for its time, it was the most amazing computer game, designed for a more upmarket crowd.
But it was more appealing to children because effectively it was a series of lights and beeps that you could stab at and jab at to follow the instructions that you'd been given.
But be warned, if he thinks you're winning, he just steps up the pace. Simon has a mind of his own.
The toy you voted in at number 76 is small but perfectly formed. That's right, it's the toy hit of the 90s, Polly Pocket. For those who never met her, Polly was an inch tall and lived in a miniature doll's house. Kate Wiggs was the first little girl to get her hands on one because her daddy, Chris, invented Polly.
Now, I'm very affectionate about Polly Pocket. She's like a character I grew up with, I suppose.
Polly Pocket was conceived in the Big Apple when Chris turned up at a toy fair and was given a big badge.
It was such a clunky, great thing, and I just looked at it and thought, you could put a house in there. That was it. But it just so happened that I had a little girl at home and a very grumpy little two-year-old, and I thought, well, I could make that for her. So this is the thing that I made, and it's a powder compact, and inside the powder compact, I just put a basic little house and a doll. So I gave it to Kate to play with, and she played and played and played with it, and about 8 years later, I thought, this is perhaps the right time to offer it to the toy industry. And I did, and the rest is history.
Two decades later, Polly is still going strong and is sold in over 40 different countries. She's made some new friends, and it's not just her property empire which has grown. Modern-day Polly is now 2.5 inches taller.
I'm a big, big girl in a big... I don't approve at all. It goes against everything I understand as being Polly Pocket, and I think I don't like her.
And the toy you decided belonged at number 75 is a real tale of derring do. Released in 1973, Escape from Colditz was the board game and TV drama series that recreated the thrill of fleeing a prisoner of war camp without the risk of actual death.
In it, there were all of the accoutrements that you would need to make an escape. So you would have to collect cards that had wire cutters on them. You'd need forged documents. You'd need rope, and you would need food and supplies.
The chap behind the game itself, which made it so special, was a chap called Pat Reed. Not only was it Colditz, he was the first British escape officer, and he was the one who designed the game. He was the one who really helped bring it to life, really gave that authenticity.
Strategy, tunnels, guards, courage, they're all here in this board game invented by Major Reed himself. Escape from Colditz.
But as with all good war games, someone had to play the baddies.
One team has to decide to play the Nazis. And that's always a difficult moral choice to make for any 8-year-old child.
Now, Doc, some of you would think of escapes.
We shoot those who try.
Not all prisoners were happy with the commercialization of the Colditz story. Some felt that it was a period of time that should be put to rest and we shouldn't keep perpetuating this story. But there were others who knew the individuals were there and said this is one great way of us never forgetting what these guys went through.
I should warn any viewers of a nervous disposition to leave the room at this point. What I'm about to show you was once considered the greatest threat to Western civilization ever. If you can bear to look, then I give you the Furby. But he's so cute, you say. Exactly. That was their sinister master plan, you monster.
9 this morning, and 150 people are waiting for the chance to pacify a child. Some had been here half the night, and all to get their hands on an interactive pet in a choice of synthetic fur coverings, designed in America, made in China, and hyped beyond belief.
In 1998, the Furbies were unleashed on an unsuspecting public.
I've been to Florida and they hadn't got any in America. I've been to Leicester, I've been to Peterborough, and I've finally come to Norwich and got one.
How much would you pay for one of these? I'd pay a couple of £100 for my children, no problem.
In the first year alone, 27 million Furbies were sold. That's approximately one Furby every second. So what was the big deal then?
Furbies have their own language, which is Furbish. I love you is Ka Mei Mei Unai.
Cleverly, the Furby was programmed to start speaking English over time, making the kids think it could listen and learn, but making the American government rather paranoid.
A lot of people said you could teach Furbies words and things. You can't do that. It doesn't have any recording in it or anything like that. They were banned in the White House because people thought that Furbies could record what people were saying and could kind of get hidden messages in and that kind of thing.
Oh no, toy number 73 is broken.
Don't worry, we can rebuild him.
In the mid-70s, us kids were glued to the $6 million man, the TV show about a US astronaut re-engineered by boffins to have superhuman powers.
We can rebuild him. We have the technology.
Undoubtedly the greatest TV show ever to spawn a toy.
Colonel Steve Austin, the $6 million man, and bionic transport and repair station.
The rocket's crashing!
We'll put him in the bionic repair station. We can rebuild him.
That toy was the epicenter of my childhood. I remember when my friend Doug first told me that he saw a $6 million man doll at the store. And I still remember to this day him describing to me how you could take the skin and roll it up the arm and reveal the bionic chips in the arm. And I could not get to a toy store fast enough.
It's corroded a bit here, and you can see it's starting to look a bit like Freddy Krueger's cheeks. And but yeah, it's a fantastic toy, and as you can see, this one here, which is my actual one, is holding a rubber iron girder.
Yes, the real Steve Austin was almost as strong as the toy.
You see, he's got a button here also. That's interesting, because that makes his... Look at the fun.
They did his bionic vision by putting a hole in the back of the Steve Austin character's head, and you as a kid would look through this little hole in the back of his head and kind of see through kind of a little magnifying glass in his eye.
So not only is it encouraging you to work out so you can lift up rubber iron girders, it's encouraging you to be a peeping Tom.
From the $6 million man to the $6 billion toy.
Ah! Do you know what these are?
Beanie babies.
I love Beanie Babies. They're so cute. My sister had a whole collection, honestly, like millions and billions of them.
Beanie Babies were launched in the early 90s as a collectible toy, but were cleverly never advertised. Periodically, manufacturer Ty chose to retire individual characters, which fed the hype. Soon, rumour started to spread that these babies would one day be worth a lot of beans.
Well, do you know, these are very collectible these days.
Yeah, but I like the cat and that one and that one.
You can get cats, you can get dogs, you can get, like...
I've never heard of them.
And they all have names. They all have names, like, this one's called Bentley. And random names.
Prickles!
With over 250 characters in the range, Beanie Babies are still considered a collector's item, so you might want to see if you have any in the bottom of your toy box.
Keep all the original boxes and keep all the original packaging, because that's what makes things very important, very valuable.
Next up, a spaceman who eventually became a household name.
It's not my fault!
They came up with a toy that was originally called Lunar Larry. He was a spaceman figure, but much more kind of retro. And Lunar Larry eventually became Tempest from Morph, and then ultimately became Buzz Lightyear as we know him.
To infinity and beyond, perhaps, but he's certainly not to be found on the toy shelves. Buzz has already sold out.
There isn't any to be had anywhere, and I understand from my colleague that there aren't any to be had anywhere in Europe.
Incredibly, the toy you voted in at number 71 nearly didn't make it off the big screen at all.
You know, it's so ironic, but when we made the first Toy Story, none of the major toy companies were even remotely interested in doing any toys for the film. And that was really because nobody knew who we were. Nobody knew who Pixar was. We had no track record, and nobody wanted to take a chance on us.
Come on, guys. Let's get our parts together, get ready, and go out on a high note.
Thankfully, a small firm, Thinkway Toys, looked into Buzz's tractor beam and saw the light.
It wasn't that long ago that they actually cranked out their 10 millionth Buzz Lightyear, so it's just amazing.
But you can't please all the kids all the time.
The problem with this one that you've given me, it's the budget one. This one might as well be the shampoo version, where you twist his head off and shampoo comes out. Yeah.
People loved the movie. They loved the characters, and they've become a part of our cultural fabric. And as a result, Buzz Lightyear has just become just an iconic toy.
At number 70, it's another hit TV show that transformed the toy market.
Mighty Morphin Power Rangers! Lord Zedd's aliens are attacking! Activate the action feature Ninja Rangers with their amazing powers!
Save the world.
Power Rangers first aired on US TV in 1993, and soon millions of children all over the world had morphed into Power Ranger fans. Naturally, the action figures soon followed, meaning kids could recreate the Mighty Morphin battles in their own bedroom.
Action feature Ninja Rangers and evil space aliens from Bandai, turning up the power.
Anyway, Ted, let's play a game. Chess or buckaroo? Actually, I wouldn't mind a game of the old chess today myself.
Really?
No, only joking, Ted. Buckaroo.
A long way from the knacker's yard, buckaroo has been delighting and frustrating households for 40 years and is still as popular as ever.
But carefully does it, because you never know when he's going to... Buckaroo, partner!
Buckaroo, the sport of kings.
Your toy at number 68 is definitely one for the girls.
Baby's name is Tiny Tears, and she's such a pretty, cuddly doll, like a real baby. Tiny Tears adores her bath time, and Tiny Tears loves her feed. She drinks and has to be changed.
You had that responsibility, and you felt like the mother, and you could carry your baby around with you and do everything that your mum would do with your brothers and sisters.
When she cries real tiny tears, you can sing her to sleep.
Tiny tears, you're my very own baby. Mother's here, tiny tears, singing you a lullaby.
Now 45 years young, Tiny Tears has managed to cry a river through the 60s and 70s right through to the present day, providing a pertinent biology lesson to young people everywhere.
As with all dolls, it pretty much looked like the Bride of Chucky meets Hamble from Play School anyway, and it was pretty terrifying. It became even more terrifying if you decided one day on a whim to feed it Ribena, and then these red tears would come streaming down its face.
I, of course, don't cry at anything, except the end of Toy Story 3 and Bambi. Oh, and I cry at weddings sometimes, and if I see puppies and kittens. Actually, I'm like a tap, I can't turn it off. See you after the break.
This, to me, is the greatest toy ever. Look at the styling. Look how cool he is. Look at his jumpsuit.
100 greatest toys. Each are going to be right the back. Woo-hoo!
Welcome back to our top 100 countdown of the UK's greatest toys, as chosen by you, the public, through an online vote and poll. Now, everyone loves a catfight. Two queen bees going at each other, hell for leather, teeth bared, fur flying. But long before Cheryl Cole and Louis Walsh even met, two gorgeous young ladies were sharpening their claws and preparing for war. By 1963, American glamour puss Barbie was a healthy 4 years old. But as Britain began to swing, we got a dolly bird of our very own, called Cindy.
Cindy. Cindy's one of the great dolls.
This is the beautiful world of Cindy, your favourite dress-up doll.
But unlike Barbie, Cindy was much more the stay-at-home girl, more likely to be pulling a pint in your local than entering Miss World.
She was dependable. She was reliable. She's essentially wholesome. She's a country girl at heart, I think. She still wore makeup. There's some blue eyeshadow there, and I think she's tweezed at her eyebrows. And she's got a little bit of lipstick. And she's also got working, jointed elbows, which is good for waving. Can Barbie do that? I think you'll find not.
OK, well, Barbie did win the Battle of the Dolls and achieve global domination, but despite the golfing glamour, for nearly 50 years, we Brits have stuck by our Cindy, and that's why she's made your list of 100 greatest toys.
I only had a Cindy because I wasn't allowed a Barbie. I think my mum thought that Cindy was more wholesome. I think she thought that Cindy was a better role model for me.
She wasn't, basically. What's the word you'd use to describe Barbie?
In reflection and looking back, I'm glad I had a Cindy, because if I was to give a doll to my child now, I'd give her a Cindy. You can have what I had. She's a lot more wholesome. You can learn a lot from Cindy. You're not having a Barbie.
Next,
time to reinvent the wheel.
Here comes the Shoop Shoop Hula Hoop. Get in on the fun with the Shoop Shoop Hula Hoop.
How do you copyright a shape? Well, you do what American toy company Wham-O did in 1958, and you patent a plastic hoop and call it Hula Hoop. Then you call your bank manager.
The Hula Hoop, I think in some ways, was the follow-up to the ball as a very basic, fundamental invention that's so simple and yet provides an unending amount of entertainment or indeed physical exercise.
A five-decade-long craze ensued, and there probably isn't a kid who hasn't at some point played with a hula hoop. And that's why it's your 66th greatest toy ever. The toy you voted for at number 65 is a genuine fantasy island. Iconic 60s TV series Thunderbirds has for over 50 years provided a whole host of toys that have delighted generations of kids. But the pièce de résistance was in 1992 when Tracy Island hit the shops.
Tracy Island itself is such an amazing toy because you've got all these hidden compartments. If you flip open the swimming pool, you've got the launch pad for Thunderbolt 1 or 2. And then you've also got the main base as well, which opens up, and it's so cool.
Now, if you can find Tracy Island in the shops, and it's not easy, it could cost you as much as £34.99, but this one is created entirely from junk.
But not every child was so lucky to be given the real thing. Step forward, Blue Peter and Anthea Turner.
Look, Tracy Island.
When Tracy Island happened on Blue Peter, it was possibly one of the most revolutionary makes we'd ever done, ever.
Thunderbird 2 can go straight the way through it. Now, the control tower is made out of a cheese. Cut out the base and then cut it in half. Now then.
Sorry, hang on, Anthea. What was I supposed to do there?
This is actually my favourite because it's the papier-mâché bit. Now then, when you've finished it...
Hang on, I haven't even started yet.
Anyone I speak to on the street, oh, yeah, Tracy Island, all right. I was like, yeah, did you make it? Nah, I got stuck when I was making the little ball thing. And it's honestly the hardest makes ever.
And that really is it. So, brains, I hope you're pleased with your brand new home. Oh, please.
It's very nice, isn't it, Lady Penelope?
There's a lot to remember, though, isn't there, brains?
But if you can conquer Tracy Island, you can make Tracy Island. Give me a call. I'll give you a badge.
Quite a guy, that, brains.
I should get him to give me a helping hand with my design for my new loft conversion.
The next toy you voted for is literally four starving animals gobbling up balls. It's Hungry Hippos.
If you want to win the game, you gotta take a good aim and get the most marbles with your hippo.
Not slagging off the makers of the game. I'm sure it's subtle genius, but it's not the most strategic, is it, you know? You just basically whack a button and hope for the best and hope the balls go into your hippo's mouth.
Hungry, hungry hippos is the name of the game. And who's ever hippo gets the most marbles wins.
Playing hungry, hungry hippos. Hungry, hungry hippos.
I win.
Hungry, hungry hippos. New from Hasbro.
Now from a stunt gone wrong to a stunt gone wrong.
This is Evel Knievel and his stunt cycle. He's the only rider to do so many stunts. Mid-air somersaults.
In the mid-70s, the Evel Knievel stunt bike was the toy for all junior daredevils and soon-to-be biker girls.
This, to me, is the greatest toy ever. Look at the styling. Look how cool he is. Look at his jumpsuit.
For our younger viewers, Evel Knievel was an icon of the 1970s. A fearless stuntman whose feats of derring-do on his souped-up motorcycle thrilled the entire world.
Absolutely horrific. It's incredible to believe that anybody could survive crashes like that.
Evel Knievel was the most iconic stuntman in the world, but there was only one Evel Knievel.
I am a professional life risker. I think the best piece of advice that I could give to any young person or anyone riding a motorcycle is don't be a fool. Don't ever ride a motorcycle without a helmet.
And the thing is, when the toy came out, you got your hands on him and you could be Evel Knievel. You could play with Evel Knievel and you could make him do those jumps. You know, it was incredible.
You know, I would argue that Evel Knievel was the most realistic toy ever made. And this is because more often than not, the real Evel ended up falling off his ramps and scraping along the tarmac. In his career, he broke a world record 50 bones and ended up with one leg shorter than the other. So the toy normally wound up exactly like the real thing.
You would just build all these stunts for him to go over. So you'd make a ramp, and then you put all the other toys along, and it'd get longer and longer and longer. And, you know, it would just a whole day's worth of playing, waiting for him to actually make the jump, which was quite rare, if I'm honest.
Is this the big moment, or is he going to have one more trial run at it? You just can never tell with this fellow. He's so unpredictable.
Don't fail me now.
Is this going to be the real thing? It's full speed, and he's rising up the ramp now.
No!
And he's made it. No, he's crashed on the run-in.
It's real!
Next, the toy that encouraged kids to play with their food. Naughty. Back in 1952, the first toy to be advertised on television was advertised on television.
But Snow Hasbro?
Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head with their own cars and trailers. That's what's new. See, Mr. Potato Head has a car and boat trailer. And there's a car and shopping trailer for his wife, Mrs. Potato Head.
In those days, there was only three channels, so there's a very good chance of a kid seeing that commercial, and millions of kids did, and it took off.
You can make the funniest looking people in the whole world. He'd had people look different every time you make them.
Back then, Mr. Potato was a bunch of little sharp pieces that got stuck into real potatoes, and later into carrots and pears and everything else. But as the laws changed and sharp point hazards were no longer able to be used in the toy industry, they started making plastic Mr. Potato Heads.
Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head with cars and trailers come in $1 and $2 sizes.
With the success of the Bond films in the mid-60s, you couldn't move for spy toys, and this is probably my favourite, Agent Zero's movie camera and machine gun. But this isn't the spy toy you voted in at number 61. Oh, no, that spot belongs to 007.
Behold, the most iconic object in the history of mankind, James Bond's Aston Martin DB5, complete with its deadly array of weaponry, machine guns, bumper rammers, tire slashers, bulletproof shield and a famous ejector seat, just a few other things on offer. And it first came to our attention in 1964, amidst the hype and the hysteria surrounding the release of that Bond classic, Goldfinger.
I think unexpectedly to the producers, as well as the public, the car actually became the star of that film because it was so modern and magical and deadly.
Modern, magical, deadly sounds ideal for a boy's toy. And within a year, a fully operational Corgi model was available.
My dad says it's worth about £800. It's from 1965, which is, my dad thinks this is really cool.
It was great. It was just, it did what the real one did in the film, you know?
It had the bulletproof plate came up the back, spikes had come out of the wheels, the machine guns coming out the front. That's the appeal of James Bond. It's the gadget nature. It's you press buttons and things pop out. That's what all these gadgets in the films are about. And that's what appeals to kids and grown men.
And they had an ejector seat. You press the button on the side. And the plastic seat would fly into the air and disappear behind the sofa, never to be found again.
Where the bloody hell's the agent? No, he's gone. Somewhere, I expect there's somebody on eBay who's got sort of collections of these little men. They're selling them for all those people who got the cars without the man that flies out the roof.
From a toy with a license to kill to a toy that wanted the world to be a better place.
Who needs a Care Bear hug?
I do! Friendly hugs, cheery hugs, bedtime hugs to share.
Ready to fight evil with their relentless good cheer, it's the Care Bears. And in 1984, they were set for world domination.
The Care Bears are here. Let's give them a cheer in the Hall of the Hearts.
Every day can be a Care Bear day. You can care and share and way.
Sold as cuddly toys and plastic figures, they also starred in their own TV shows, movies and books, with merchandise sales totalling over $3.5 billion.
What I like is the art-shaped nose. Isn't it cute?
Next up, from the man who invented these, the 3D game with the very appropriate name.
You need patience to play Kaplunk.
You just pull out the sticks without letting any marbles fall, because when they do...
It's straw pulley marble drop game. It's tower o' marbles with pulley thing. Oh, I don't know. Kaplunk!
Want to play?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll start.
But if you just feel it loose, that's a loosen. There we go. Off she goes. See?
Oh!
If you feel any tension on the stalk, my advice to a kaplunk player would be leave well alone.
One day my dad just turned up with this game and it just looked really weird. And I decided to see how many marbles I could stick up my nostrils and I got one stuck. Now I took kaplunk to another level, man.
I think kaplunk is really a great game because it encourages the family to get together and really enjoy themselves. And I think that's what we should be keeping in mind when we invent toys and games.
What would you call it?
Every girl wants a pony, but before this next toy, it was the impossible dream.
My little ponies love going for pony rides, but their favourite thing of all is being made a fuss of. There are 6 different ones to choose from. My Little Pony from Hasbro.
Believe it or not, this multi-million selling, quintessentially girls' toy was born out of the misadventures of a little boy.
We had introduced a product called My Pretty Pony, which was a plastic, clunky, large size pony with yarn hair. And I had given it to my son, who was 2 years old at the time, to play with it. And he was playing with it, and he hit himself in the head with it and started to cry. And I said, there's got to be a better way to do this. Maybe we should make them smaller and softer. And that was the birth of My Little Pony.
The creators of My Little Pony had stumbled upon a formula to fulfill young girls' desire. Miniature ponies in bright pastel colours with tattoos of stars on their rumps. Oh, and not forgetting the magical ingredient, hair.
Each pony was a different colour. It had long hair. You always got a brush with it so you could brush the hair, you could brush the tail.
And it really was nothing more than a doll. And the key feature to any doll is the hair play.
Girls like horses and girls like hair. So together, this is the dream toy.
And from the dream toy, you voted number 58 to a truly surreal one at 57. It's none other than the Space Hopper. Right from its launch in 1968, it was one of those toys you just couldn't resist.
I remember first seeing one and thinking, yeah, I'll have a bit of that, this will be fun. And immediately coming off it.
I love Space Hoppers. They've always got that weird little face on them. It's always smiling at you, like...
Whenever you see a Space Hopper in the room, you have to get on and jump around on it like a lunatic. I don't know what makes you do that.
There we go.
Talking of lunatics, meet Ashrita Furman, a man who never quite grew out of his space hopper. In 2005, he travelled to the Great Wall of China, where he successfully broke the 15-minute barrier, securing the record for the fastest mile on a space hopper.
Really, you get into this rhythm, and you can really, you know, bounce. And it really can become quite graceful. You have to really get a bounce and, you know, use your legs. You know, a lot, you know, most of it's really coming from your quads here. In my training one time, I was bouncing along, like really going at a good clip, and all of a sudden, the thing exploded, and I found myself flat on the ground, and it was a real shock. You know, I actually kind of banged up my knees. So that's the only danger, is when you're going really fast on the space hopper, you know, the thing can explode.
The toy you voted in at number 56 will never self-destruct.
They were tough, weren't they, Tonka toys? I mean, really, really, really tough.
Let her go.
We took 2 of the world's toughest trucks and a 400-foot cliff.
And what about this for an advertisement?
They were indestructible. I mean, like, when Armageddon does come, and the world is completely destroyed, scorched earth everywhere, the only things that will remain are mutants and Tonka toys.
And this is the truck made by Tonka.
Next, a board game with a pretty long shelf life.
The original game of life was called the checkered game of life, and it was Milton Bradley's first game in 1860. And it was sort of a moral game. You moved forward by being honest and working hard, and you went backwards if you gambled or lied.
However, to celebrate the centenary of the game, Milton Bradley thought the game of life could do with an update for a new generation with a new moral code. Enter game designer Reuben Claimer.
To win the game of life, you have to accumulate the most amount of money.
Gambling led to ruin in the original game, but in the 1960s version, when Vegas was booming, you could win 50 grand by going to Vegas.
It's the facts of life, pure and simple.
You owe me $95,000, and I want it now.
But what about me and my four children?
I'm going to have to sell the cattle ranch.
How much?
Yes, this is the board game you voted for, where it's fun to ruin the lives of your family.
$10,000. When you see their father go to jail, they laugh at him. When mother loses her money or whatever, they laugh at her. So it's a good element of bonding.
I think parents liked it because it sort of taught kids some sort of grown-up skills, and kids liked it because they got to pretend to be an adult.
I made $50,000 in the stock market today.
I had twins! That's life!
Time to address the other side of the game of life, and that would be death.
Now, this may not look like it, and you haven't been drinking too much cognac, but this is a rare animal. This is a Tamagotchi.
Back in 1996, the world was in the grips of an epidemic that started in Japan. No, not bird flu, but Tamagotchi, the revolutionary interactive kids' pet toy that fitted in your pocket. And since their release, over 70 million have been sold.
You had to feed him and play with him and stroke him, and if you did, he would become well-mannered, and if you didn't, he would become ill-mannered and rude and would die.
I had one Tamagotchi, and it really annoyed me because I went on holiday for a week and I came back and it was dead.
Some psychologists are concerned about the possible long-term effects on children.
There's been loads of reports in the press about children needing bereavement counselling because of the death of their Tamagotchi.
Are you serious? Bereavement counselling?
It was a week. Even I can survive that long without food.
Why are you dying? I've given you everything you need and want and desire in life.
I let Mum look after it, and then when he came back from school one day, it was dead.
I left it for, half an hour, and I looked at it and it was dead.
That's what being a kid's all about, killing digital animals.
A tip for parents. Don't tell the kids that their Tamagotchi is dead. Just say it went to live on a farm in Devon. Join us after the break when we'll have more toys than you'll find in the back of Santa's wardrobe.
The Atari video game.
They remind me of those American dragster racing bikes. They looked extremely sporting.
Basically, I think it's like pasta.
Welcome back. Toy inventing looks easy, doesn't it? Hardly rocket science, you might think. Well, that's where you're wrong, because the next toy was invented by a genuine NASA egghead space boffin. And I think that's his official title as well.
In 1969, the brains at NASA were behind man's most glorious technological achievement, the lunar landings. Despite this giant leap for mankind, back on Earth, water fights were still a little bit basic.
When I was a kid, water pistols were very humble little things.
We had little tiny ones. You had to keep running back to the tap, filling up.
And you'd get this little drizzle.
Cue NASA rocket scientist Dr. Lonnie Johnson and the appliance of science that led to the water pistol revolution.
I was at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California at the time, working on outer planetary spacecraft, and I machined some nozzles, and I was experimenting in the bathroom and hooked these nozzles up to my bathroom sink. Shot the stream of water across the bathroom and thought to myself, boy, this would make a neat water gun.
And so was born the Super Soaker.
It's like replacing a spear with a nuclear weapon.
The desert, the last place on Earth you'd expect. Now deliver double-drenching power with the all-new Super Soaker XP55.
I did want it to be a gun that could be pumped very easily, but yet pumped to very high pressure so you would get the high performance.
The Super Soaker, it really created a whole category of toys, which is the, you know, the air-powered water pistol market, which became over $100 million business overnight.
Just as man continues to evolve, so too does the Super Soaker. It's now bigger, better, and wetter than ever before.
Now I'm going to demonstrate the firepower of the Monster Super Soaker.
Well, that's one way to get him clean. At number 52, you voted for the game for wannabe surgeons that's been around since 1965.
It's my turn to operate.
Operate?
You messed it up, Butterfingers!
It's Operation, the Mad Doctor's Game.
Obviously, you can tell it's an American game because you get money for removing the organs. This is clearly not the NHS we're dealing with here.
Here goes his funny bone.
You need a very steady hand.
I did it. That's £200 for me.
Can I have a go?
Operation, the Mad Doctor's Game from MB Games.
Next, stranger things have happened at sea.
My husband was a mechanical engineer and marine engineer. And he was out on the trial run of a naval ship for the Cramp shipyard. And the spring fell off a table, and that gave him the idea that he might be able to make it walk. He was very inventive and very ingenious. And I thought, oh no, not another thing he's going to come up with. But this was very successful.
Betty James named her husband's invention the Slinky, and they never looked back because although it only did one thing, it did it really well.
Watching it coming down the stairs, you know, the final step where it just piles down like that, there's nothing like it. It's just a great, pure sensation of joy.
Where some found Nirvana in a Slinky coming to rest, creator Richard James felt the need to look elsewhere.
He became involved in a religious cult. And he decided that he was going to go to South America, and he went to Bolivia. He said to me, what are you going to do? Sell the company or run it? And without thinking, I said, why, of course I'll run it. He was always looking for something new, something different. And I guess the cult in Bolivia appealed to him, so he went there.
At number 50 is the toy that only came about because of a rise in the price of oil in 1973. Oil's essential in the production of plastic, and German manufacturer Bahnstatter turned away from making giant plastic toys and made these Playmobil play people instead. So thank you, rich oil shake people. So we're just past the halfway mark, and I'd like to celebrate by shouting something. Yahtzee!
Yahtzee!
What's the big, big game in every corner of the world? It's that international hit...
Yahtzee.
Yes, Yahtzee. You play it with 5 dice and score it like poker, 13 ways. Hey, a high straight, that's worth 40 points.
Yahtzee appeals primarily because it's one of those games that's easier to play than it is to explain. And it also has that inbuilt family appeal that you get to shout out when you've achieved a score and when you hit a Yahtzee.
Yahtzee!
And number 48, a toy that is the ultimate challenge for the mind. A pure test of logical thinking. No, not Hungry Hippos, it's Mastermind.
The game consisted of arranging pegs on a board and then covering up the pegs, and you had to try and gradually work out, it's a bit like battleships really, the exact arrangement of pegs that was hidden.
It was essentially code-breaking.
It's all about probabilities, isn't it, and like being a detective. It was a superb, brilliant idea.
You needed your own little Enigma machine to do that.
Speaking of Enigma, what helped define Mastermind in our brains was the enigmatic packaging.
Strange looking bloke with a beard.
University professor.
That's not Magnus Magnusson.
At this point in proceedings, it behoves me to remind you that despite their emergence in the 1970s, Mastermind the game bears no relation to Mastermind the TV show. However, since it started, it hasn't finished, and it continues to sell today. For some, it remains a specialist subject.
I remember it kind of made me feel quite smart, because I'm really unmathematical and scientific.
Some people could do it in 2 moves, 3 moves. I had a go the other day, actually, still can't work out how you do it.
And it turned me into, briefly, a code breaker for 6 years for MI5, which is something I completely forgot.
And now for a major shock in our countdown, as one of the biggest selling toys of all time appears only at number 47. All I'm saying is, Ken, if you're watching, I'd take yourself down the pub for an hour or two. Barbie's going to be in a foul mood after this. Ever since her arrival in 1959, Barbie has beguiled little girls everywhere and even the odd boy or two.
When I was a child, Barbie to me was the perfect woman.
It's the big hair and the blue eyes, the long eyelashes, it's the whole package.
She had a gorgeous boyfriend. Yeah, she just had the lot. I loved her.
It's the embodiment of the American dream.
Or so it seemed, because Barbie had foreign ancestry. One day, the head of marketing came across something he hadn't seen before in the company archives.
I opened up a box. There was a doll that looked 90% like Barbie, but the date that it was acquired was before Barbie was designed.
Marvin reported his find to his boss, Jack Ryan.
I said, Jack, look at this. This is like the Barbie doll. He said, so? But the date is before Barbie.
In fact, Barbie's blonde roots were actually German and rather rude.
Barbie was inspired by a doll from Germany. The Lily doll was sort of a doll of ill repute. It wasn't made for little German girls. It was made for a gag gift for adult men.
During a trip to Europe, co-founder of Mattel, Ruth Handler, had come across the Bild Lily doll and taken it home. Barbie. 3 years later, re-engineered and given a makeover, All-American Barbie was revealed to the world.
My Barbie doll is really real.
Today, Barbie is over 50 years old, and it's thought that 3 Barbies are sold every second. Freewheeling into your chart at number 46, it's the trusty two-wheel steed that made a virtue of style over substance.
For me, this was the number one toy. When you owned one of these, it was the equivalent of owning a two-wheeled Rolls Royce.
When you were on that, you were on a motorbike.
It's something straight out of Easy Rider.
The coolest thing.
The Raleigh Chopper, a design classic.
They remind me of those American dragster racing bikes, but the front wheel is much smaller than the back wheel, and the rider sits right at the back end here with these high roll bars behind him. It looks extremely sporting.
Understandably, many claim credit for its iconic appearance. Not only the good people at Raleigh, but also the team responsible for the Reliant Robin.
I think I made up my mind, even at the meeting, that it would have a big wheel and a small wheel because of this business of transmitting the power through the rear wheel like a Formula One car.
Well, whoever was responsible, this brave new world of bicycling was not without its flaws.
Although aesthetically the bikes looked great, they were real pig's ears to ride.
You'd never win the Tour de France on one.
It was designed for, you know, going quite slowly to the newsagents and buying some fizzers and going home again. You couldn't do wheelies. If you tried to do a wheelie, you would just go straight over backwards because it was very, very heavy at the back.
Wheelies were the least of your worries when manhandling your chopper.
The dangerous thing with the chopper bike is that the gears are down here rather than on the handlebars.
The gear stick was in a very poorly positioned place if you're a boy and you're on a bike that might stop suddenly.
It was good for a girl, anyway, it was good. But it was probably handed down from my brother and well, he's gone on to have 4 kids, so it's probably fine, isn't it?
Your 45th greatest toy proves that the route to gaming success need not be a hard one.
I absolutely love Pictionary. I've played it since I was a kid and we still play it now every Christmas.
Right, here we go.
I came up with Pictionary after college. I graduated, moved in with 3 buddies and started sketching words out of the dictionary to each other. So I decided to look at it as a board game and, like all good entrepreneurs, didn't do anything with it for 3 years.
Rob's light bulb moment came when his mother sent him a certain board game for his birthday.
So I open up the Trivial Pursuit, I look at the card, and I go, oh, that's how you make Pictionary into a board game.
From a humble start of just 1,000 copies cobbled together in his apartment, Pictionary soon became an almost effortless worldwide hit.
But it was just such an adventure. You know, the partners and I, Terry and Gary and Rich, we just had a ball doing it.
What's that?
I am not a good Pictionary player, to be honest. Having me in your team is not an advantage. Oops.
Pictionary still delights and frustrates a million new households every year.
It was a tapeworm. That's a tape.
Well, it was a tube. It's open on either end, so I was trying to get the impression that things were going right through it. But as I've mentioned, I pretty much suck at my own game.
At number 44, you voted for a pie-in-the-sky idea from another world.
Flying saucers have fascinated people for nearly 20 years now. And in the past months, reports of sightings have flooded in faster than ever before. British ufologists say that the visitors from space are shaped like men, mostly about a yard high.
Into a world of UFO paranoia came the plastic disc shaped like a flying saucer named after a pie company in Connecticut, the Frisbee, or at least that's what they called it in America.
It's a great little gadget called Getaway that promises to become a teenage craze. It skims, it soars, it hovers.
Well, it should have done, but in Britain we never quite got the hang of the Getaway, let alone the Frisbee. And for Frisbee proper, you've got to go to the US of A.
Rolling it across your chest, that's called a body roll. The bad attitude, the delay.
Yep, Frisbee's plainly not cricket.
You can't play Frisbee in the rain, obviously. In the snow, it's terrible and windy. Like, oh, I'm playing Frisbee in a park. It's just not going to happen.
No such problems in sunny California.
I think there's something about flight, about how the Frisbee hovers in the air, and then also sort of the creativity that you can have with the Frisbee. So you can play freestyle and do fancy tricks, or you can push yourself and try to throw it as far as you want. You can take it in so many different directions. It was an immediate sensation as a toy, and it's lasted 50 years.
Join us after the break when we'll be taking a look at this wooden block building game, Jenga. Now, Jenga, of course, is a Swahili word, which loosely translates as, who's going to pick up all of these bricks? Still to come, toys from a galaxy far, far away, and everybody's favourite furry friend. As you can see, I'm a 7th Dan black belt Jenga master, and to be this good takes inner calm, nerves of steel, and immense eye-to-hand coordination. And also, quite a lot of glue.
Jenga, Jenga, Jenga.
You take a block from the bottom and you put it on top. You take a block from the middle and you put it on top. It teeters and it totters and you build it up. It weevils and it wobbles, but you don't give up.
It has that feeling that it's been around forever, but it hasn't. I mean, it's only been around for about 30 years.
Leslie came up with the idea for Jenga in the 1980s when playing around with her younger brother's wooden building blocks.
A game kind of evolved. And every time I showed it to somebody, they loved it and they hadn't come across it before. So it suddenly dawned on me that this was a unique game. Why not try and market it?
From that day to this, over 50 million sets have been sold worldwide. That's over 2.7 billion little wooden bricks. Next, a toy so great you may have noticed that this evening I'm wearing some on my face. It's Fuzzy Felt.
Fuzzy Felt started with a set called Fuzzy Felt Pictures. That was in September 1950. My mother then designed a whole lot of different items. Best known and remembered probably are the farm, the circus, and the hospital.
And Lois Allen's designs have been enduring ever since.
I'm quite surprised it's still around with all these your Wii's and PlayStation 3's, and people want to stick felt onto this fuzzy bit. That's why it's called Fuzzy Felt.
The kind of world was quite soft, so that was quite nice. Seemed like quite a nice world to be in, Fuzzy Felt world.
I think my mother would be extremely proud of the fact that the product is still enduring, the fact that it's on a list of 100 best toys. She was still at her drawing board a few months before she died, and she had left very special instructions that her memorial stone should have a subcaption of Mrs. Fuzzy Felt.
Next, a giant among toys. In an unassuming shop on a wet, windy North London street lurks a world within a world. Now, you might not know anything about it, but for the converted, it's a very special place indeed.
Sylvanian families are a collection of small woodland animals. It centres around doll's house style play, traditional doll's house play. So they live in houses, they go to school, they work in shops, they live in families.
These furry little critters arrived in Britain from Japan in 1987 and have remained an evergreen staple of the playroom ever since.
For the younger children, they love creating the stories, moving the characters around, doing the voices.
Are you all right there, madam? Yes, I'm having a drip. OK, there we go. That's fine.
For the older children, it's the detail. They can create really realistic scenes.
I collect them. I pretend I'm collecting them for my children, but actually I'm collecting them very much for myself, because when they leave home, those Sylvanians are going to stay with me. I absolutely adore them.
At number 40, you chose a toy which is easy to explain.
Build the craziest mousetrap that was ever made to catch a mouse. Kick the bucket down the chute, turn the handle, take a dive, and...
Mousetrap! Well, I remember first seeing it, the advert for Mousetrap, and sort of being, like, almost sort of open-mouthed in awe.
And it was great fun. At least it appeared like that in the ad.
And I really believed that I would never get bored of it. And, of course, I got bored of it.
Actually, when I saw him for the first time, I was deeply disappointed. It just did nothing worked.
I just remember setting it up and just trying to get it to work.
It wasn't the most exciting game, but to see, after all your hard work of putting it together, to see the little action of the ball was a big thrill.
War, hey? What is it good for? Well, as we all know, absolutely nothing. But the Vietnam War did have some strange ramifications on the world of toy cars. In the 1960s, the quaint British model car industry was motoring along without a care in the world.
The whole thing with Corgi and Lesney was like a Morris Minor trundling on slightly bent axles with wheels made of rubber.
But when America entered the Vietnam War in 1965, it seriously dented Mattel's sales in combat toys. So they decided to enter the toy car market, inspired by the hot new thing, drag racing.
What Hot Wheels did was said, wow, look at this, it's got shiny rims, it's got big headlights, it's jazzed up.
Hot Wheels, brand new, Hot Wheels. For you, genuine, fiery Hot Wheels, all new.
And you just go whiz, and it would go off and the cat would swallow it or it would get stuck under a rock.
We will hardly ever do anything that resembles a family sedan, because that's what kids want. They don't want their mom's minivan. They want something that's going to go really fast.
Hot Wheels went on to buy out its British competitor, Matchbox, and to this day have produced over 4 billion toy cars. The toy you placed at number 38 is an undeniable hit!
H7. Hit. B6. Miss. H8. Hit.
People just going D4. Someone will go hit or miss. Not that exciting.
C5.
So somebody brilliantly then said, I know, why don't we pretend that this board is a piece of ocean and that these lines of pegs are actually aircraft carriers and destroyers and this is actually an exciting battle at sea. And we fell for it.
Battleship, a great game of strategy, action and suspense.
And it also has its own catchphrase.
You sank my battleship.
It's actually a really good game. I have no idea why. It's just the power of illusion.
The toy you decided deserved the number 37 spot brought out the inner artful dodger in the under-10s.
Now, it is supposed to be child's play, but the Pokemon card craze is in danger of turning into a mini crime wave.
They smashed through this window, making a small hole, which wasn't big enough for an adult to get through. They actually came into the shop and they only stole Pokemon cards.
Launched by Nintendo in 1996, these Japanese cartoon pocket monsters began life in video games. But it was the trading cards and their tagline, "Gotta catch 'em all," that really sent the kids doolally.
At school, people go around nicking other people's cards.
Our advice to parents is really ask children to exercise some caution. You wouldn't expect them to carry £200 of cash around. Don't expect them to carry £200 of the cards around.
I'm still actually trying to get my hands on the elusive Charizard card. Anyone swap? Next, the game that brings people closer together.
Twister! Spin the spinner and call the shot. Twister can tie you.
Yes, it's Twister, the game that in the post-Christmas dinner fug saw things get a little bit wacy.
I don't think Mum and Dad played it after we'd gone to bed. Maybe they did. I'll have to ask them. Oh, I hope they didn't. That's a bit sinister. You can't play it with two. Yes, you can play it with two, can't you?
Twister.
New from MB Games. Twister!
Warning, your next toy should be highly dangerous. It's the chemistry set. For over a century, it's been on the wish list of kiddie boffins everywhere. Goggles on.
The boy on the box of a chemistry set, he had these massive goggles on, and he'd be looking very intently at the test tube, and you just knew what he was thinking was, why won't this blow up?
I think the chemistry set is the ultimate example of a toy that promises the most and delivers the least.
What every child effectively wanted with a chemistry set was something that they could make explosives with, something they could make stink bombs with, something that they could use to poison their little sister. What they actually got was copper sulfate and slaked lime. And I don't even know what slaked lime is.
I wonder what happened to my pet turtles I flushed down the toilet back in 1984. Donatello, Raphael, Michelangelo and Leonardo began life in the minds of comic strip creators Peter Laird and Kevin Eastman.
We came up with the idea for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles pretty much as a joke. And we drew our comic book. It was drawn for us. We just knew that we wouldn't sell a single copy because it was so absurd. It was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Who's going to buy this crazy thing?
Answer, a lot of people. The comic became a cult hit and was swiftly followed by a cartoon, which helped to flog a huge range of action figures that would prove insanely popular with kids, although not necessarily their parents.
Peter and I were living in Massachusetts, and the toys came out. And as we're going down the aisle in the toy store, there's this mom pulling her kid down the aisle, and the mom's like, I'm not going to buy you one of those stupid Ninja Turtles. And we were like, oh, my God, what have we done?
Today, turtle products still rake in millions of dollars every year, and there's at least one dedicated fan still keen to snap up all the toys.
I've been collecting all the turtle toys since the beginning, and it's a lot of them. It drives my kids nuts because they want to play with them. Like, Dad, can't we open some of these? It's like, no, these are 26 years old.
Our next toy has been enjoyed by the Greeks, Renaissance gents, and the Victorians. But in the 1930s, the yo-yo was officially born when Donald Duncan smacked a patent on it and brought it to the masses.
Spring and a young man's fancy. Yes, sir, it's love at first sight when school kids in Jackson Heights, Long Island, get a glimpse of the latest in yo-yos and yo-yo techniques. Demonstrators are mobbed by avid youngsters of all...
And from the 30s to the present day, people are still going gaga for the yo-yo. So we asked this talented chap, what's the secret?
When you go deep into it and try to understand the movements, you sort of become like one with the yo-yo. You really have to understand the gravity, and performing these tricks just feels so natural. I think this is the greatest toy. It's just amazing, I think.
Next, a little knowledge can go a long way. It's Top Trumps, the card game that's been providing pub ammo for childish minds from 1977 to the present day.
Great new titles in Top Trumps.
Top Trumps gave you this, like, ridiculous knowledge.
Based on fact, we were learning. It was education for us.
No matter what set of Top Trumps you were playing, planes, trains or automobiles, it was all about the trump card.
That American stealth bomber one. Nothing could beat it for speed. If you had that, you always saved it. And you're like, have some of that, son, have some of that. Fastest plane, it's all over. Give me your trumps.
Join me after the break when we'll be unwrapping more amazing presents in our 100 greatest toys, then realising we don't have any batteries and trudging off grumpily to see if a garage is open. Welcome back to our countdown of the 100 greatest toys as selected by our online vote and national poll. Now, our next toy is the oldest toy on the list. Way back in 1760, they didn't need computer consoles to entertain them. Oh, no. They were raving about that technological marvel, the roller skate. And who better to demonstrate them than this gangling, ungainly fool?
He's not exactly thundering his way down the course. Getting his arms properly positioned to go round the pole at the end. I think that, yes, he's back, coming back again, marvellous.
Probably the most consistent toy of my whole life has been roller skates, because that's the thing that I've kind of taken with me into adult life as a toy.
I'm starting to wish I hadn't.
Heavy weather of the course here. Jonathan, what's keeping you?
Once you kind of start getting the skill you're kind of into a whole new world. And as you got kind of better and better, you could just have more and more fun on them and more, be more and more confident. The speed is basically what it's all about.
He's really powering his way round the cone there.
The more confident you are, the faster you can go downhill without kind of doing that thing where you kind of like veer off into the wall.
And end time. Yes, try and stop there, Jonathan.
Obviously, there are people who are always around you, people who are better and people who are not so good.
I guess I'm one of the ones who's not so good. Well, that's the fun over with. Now it's time for world domination.
Risk, the classic game of world domination. Use all your strategy and cunning to lead vast armies into battle and vanquish your opponents.
War, for all its awful qualities, does make a good board game because it has all the elements of war without the possibility of a sad death in a foreign land. War was stupid
and people stupid. When I was at university, we used to play Risk, but with sort of, you know, my mates who tended to be fairly lefty. And we'd sort of have a crisis halfway through the game and not really want to win because it seemed symbolic of an approach to the world that none of us really wanted to embrace.
I'm invading Western Europe.
Anyone can conquer the world playing Risk.
The people who won it were the sort of people who ended up either in the Foreign Office or we never heard of again because they went to university, studied Chinese, and we think ended up somewhere we know not where, doing important stuff on behalf of the nation.
I'm thundering into Mongolia.
Not bad for my kid sister.
Absolutely anyone can rule the world playing Risk.
You voted for another war-based toy at number 29, Spirograph. War-based, you ask? Oh, yes.
Spirograph! Fire, fire! Fantastic! Amazing! Whee! Phenomenal! Oh, super! Spirograph, a Dennis Fisher toy.
Spirograph has an interesting origin in that Dennis Fisher, the designer of it, really worked as an engineer on bomb detonate equipment. So the fact that someone in that field could come up with a toy is sort of ironic.
The secret to the success of Spirograph is, very simply put, not everyone is very good at drawing. What it enabled you to do was combine the fun of drawing with the geometry of a math lesson to create something that you could decorate and put on the fridge door and that your mum would at least think you'd managed to achieve something that day. Your mother might be less happy to find the pin marks that you'd put in her dining room table because you needed to fasten the board down so tightly, because if you didn't do that, the patterns would just come out as a weird scrawl.
The very same year that Spirograph spiralled into the world, England's triumph in the 1966 World Cup consolidated our love of football forever and our love for a certain toy designed to be played on a table with 22 plastic men balanced on buttons.
Everybody really wanted to try and recreate what they'd been watching in the World Cup in miniature.
What a match! Your two favourite teams fighting it out in your own home every day.
However, back in 1948, when the first kits were sold, Subutio was a little more basic.
My father, on a whim, he decided to put an advert in a Boy's Own and literally just test the markets. And the response to the advert was magnificent, over £4,500 worth of orders.
But unfortunately for Peter, he hadn't actually made any of the games yet, so in a hurry, he had to cut his cloth accordingly.
The only way he could get around this was to do a very, very basic set. And the first sets were actually supplied with an old army blanket from the war, with a piece of chalk, with a note in it saying, you know, have to mark out your own football pitch. He always beat me at Subutio, 'cause he flicked a
kick, and I didn't know all my perfect... But by the 1970s, Subutio had become an iconic toy, thanks in no small part to a whole range of accessories and add-ons that had begun to accumulate on bedroom floors throughout the UK.
The floodlights, the accessories packs, the manager and the coach, you could tell the difference between them because one of them was wearing a sheepskin coat. The guys on the bench, they were never going to get a game.
The reality is, it looks much better than it plays. The control you had in it wasn't like the adverts, that's for sure.
Here's a question for you. What's the only toy on our list that's won an Oscar? Well, if you get it, I'll be amazed. But it is this fantastic product. Some people can take a toy and turn it into an art form.
Plasticine was a raw material that you could do anything with. The only limits were your imagination.
Yes, at number 27, it's the non-drying modelling clay they call plasticine, responsible for firing the imagination of childlike minds since 1901.
Plasticine was always around the house, and when I started doing animation as a hobby, you know, when I was about 12 years old, it was kind of an obvious material to try out, really. I could just make my drawings into models very easily. My cartoons could become 3D.
It wasn't until this kids' TV favourite from the 70s appeared that Nick began to realise what was really possible with plasticine modelling.
And I was really inspired by what I saw on Vision On and the early morph, things I'd never tried in plasticine. I never thought that was possible because I thought it'd be too messy. And so I used to mimic that.
They might not use plasticine anymore, but the principles behind Aardman and Nick's 4 Oscar haul remains pretty much the same. And like the rest of us, Nick has never forgotten his favourite toy.
The memory of opening a packet of plasticine when I was a very young child, it was like fresh from the factory and it has a particular smell. And the way it's just so pristine, it's a magical moment, you know. And it's like the possibilities are endless and all in front of you in that one packet.
And we move seamlessly on to more modelling clay at number 26 and Play-Doh. When I was growing up, you could mould it, model it, sculpt it, but let's be honest, some fool would always end up eating it. Wonder what happened to him.
My main inspiration in my work, in my cooking, is driven by nostalgia, it's driven by childhood memories. Even now, when you smell Play-Doh, it takes you straight back to childhood. I don't know what it is. There's nothing quite like it.
So it's great fun and it smells fantastic, but how does it taste?
If you look on the container, it actually says contains wheat. And basically, I think it's like pasta. And these bits of kit are similar to pasta making machines.
Yeah, you guessed it. Inspired by his beloved Play-Doh, Heston's had an idea.
Right, so I've got here is some parsley pasta. It's basically pasta with a parsley puree. So it's going to be edible Play-Doh. And I'm going to push this through my magic pasta-forming shape machine. That is one of the great joys of Play-Doh. You just give things a go. They don't quite work. You just start again.
And after several hours, trial and error, and by using edible ingredients, Heston's Play-Doh-inspired tagliatelle is ready.
A couple of sage leaves. This is just to make a sage-flavoured butter. Add some peas. Then add the pasta. I'm in Play-Doh. Okay, now I'm going to use my highly developed laser-honed Play-Doh kitchen implements. And then finally, what's the perfect accompaniment to green Play-Doh pasta with peas? A white truffle. So if someone had said to me when I was about 4 years old, messing around with Play-Doh, my son, all this Play-Doh creativity is going to put you in good stead for the future. And in many years to come, you will be making green Play-Doh with peas and white truffle, I wouldn't have believed a word of it. And I've got Play-Doh to thank for it all.
At number 25, you voted for the computer game and console that kick-started the home gaming industry.
Here's a brand new idea from the United States which can turn your television set into a game that two can play.
It just seemed like a Martian invention. How could this be? How could you put something on your television? Just plugging this thing in, and it came on your television.
Right, Wimbledon, here we come.
We're playing something on our television. It's amazing.
You ready, Jen? Play.
Pong was just the beginning. In 1978, Atari went one giant step better, a console with interchangeable cartridges.
Well, this is what you've been asking me for over the last few months, the Atari video game and Space Invaders.
Thanks, Dad.
It's this bizarre kind of rectangular box with a wooden finish on it, A computer with a wooden finish on it. That's so cool. And it's amazing. You can buy cartridges and you can whack them in. All of these games that before you could only play in the arcade, suddenly you've got them on your telly. It's the coolest thing, man.
I remember this friend of mine had it, and then finally I got one. I don't think I left home for, well, probably about 12 years, I think, after that.
Next, the toy that came in from the cold. In 1980, from behind the Iron Curtain, came a device that bamboozled the West, the Rubik's Cube.
It's symbolic of its era. It's an incredible invention.
It's a cerebral toy, basically. You know, and maybe that's because, you know, they have a bit more time on their hands in behind the Iron Curtain to think.
Professor, how long ago did you design this?
5 years ago.
5 years? There are 3 billion possibilities, but only one answer.
There are more than 3 million. There are 43 million.
Oh, so... So it's not that difficult.
There was nothing covert about Professor Erno Rubik's masterpiece. It exploded onto the global market, and by 1982, it was estimated that one in three households in the West had one. But did you know anyone who could do it?
To this day, I didn't solve the Rubik's Cube. For me, it was a trinket. It was an objet d'art.
To be good at Rubik's Cube, you need to understand that you have to solve it in layers rather than sides.
Ah, layers. Since it came on the market, an estimated 350 million Rubik's Cubes have been sold, but it's still an elite group of men, boys and robots who can actually complete it.
He's there! He's there! Dan, 20.23 seconds. Unbelievable stuff.
Done.
At number 23, it's every child and adult's very best friend.
There's something slightly human about a bear, you know, with the long legs and the long arms.
This is my favourite teddy bear. He's called William Shakespeare.
A funny thing happened in 1902. German toy company Steiff began making cuddly bears, while across the Atlantic, President Teddy Roosevelt made headlines by refusing to kill a bear cub on a hunting trip. And so, Teddy's Bear was created. And young or old, we've loved the furry little fellas ever since.
You never fall out with a bear, do you? A bear is not, you know, a train set, a bicycle, you discard it, you might even smash it up. You'd never beat up on your bear. The bear is, you know, it's a special relationship.
Hello. Okay, so this is one of my favourite bears.
This is Patchy, my beloved, beloved, the one and only teddy bear that's ever really meant anything to me.
He's very charming.
I really, actually, really do love him. He's got the same eyes. Actually brimming, that's really embarrassing.
I'm a little bit in love with Jeremy. I think it's because it's the one thing, apart from real people, that I've had all my life. You know, and occasionally a teddy bear is sort of a little bit better than real people.
Still sleeps in my bed, between me and my husband. Just like to keep that distance. Patch is more important to me.
Who would have thought the teddy bear would only make it to number 23 on the list? They must have scared off a lot of voters with that terrifying picnic they went on. Join us after the break. Welcome back. It's an exciting moment. We're just a couple of places away from entering the final top 20 in our Christmas countdown of the greatest toys ever. Now, all the finest artists have a medium they excel in. Van Gogh worked with oils, Gainsborough with watercolours. I like to etch-a-sketch. Look at that one. Now that's a keeper.
There is a way to draw by remote control. It is called Etch-a-Sketch.
Simply turning the dials makes lines appear on the screen.
It is like magic.
With a little skill and imagination, amazing drawings can be created.
But for many, Etch-a-Sketch had a fatal flaw.
Just shake Etch-a-Sketch upside down and the screen clears.
I loved Etch-a-Sketch. The artist within me came out. Etch-a-Sketch was great, but only if you drew something angular.
Oh, like, squares?
Yes.
I'd forgotten, on holding it now, all those years later, how incredibly difficult it is. It's really hard. I'm trying to draw a circle.
At number 21, a toy that seemed to give you voters a warm glow.
I have a three-year-old at the moment, and just like me, he has a big plastic box, and it is full with about 400 Matchbox cars.
Matchbox have been delighting kids since 1953, but even today, put them into the hands of any grown adult and watch all hell break loose. Oh, yes.
There is not a boy alive who doesn't want to sit there at some stage in their life in car chase fantasies with Matchbox cars.
We're gonna get you. Hey, child, move!
You drive them up the elbow and then on the top of the sofa as if you're going round a mountain range.
Woo, 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 woo! Hey, move, child! Oh, it's a shame.
You could do this, you know.
Yes!
You can't do that to an FX model.
Abseiling in at number 20.
Action Man!
Now with eagle eyes that actually move. On the lookout for action. Up in the mountains. Down in the jungles.
Action Man was great because you could dress him up. He had medals and badges and I loved all that regalia.
It's like, well, hang on, this is a doll.
The word doll was banned from the company.
He was a doll for boys, for heaven's sakes.
It is an action figure, it's not a doll.
You're old enough to kill, but not for voting.
The genesis of this ultimate warrior was in the States with a toy called G.I. Joe.
Tell me over and over and over again, my friend.
However, in 1967, anti-Vietnam War feeling reached a crescendo. And in the midst of falling sales, he came over here, where the kids were a little less squeamish about the Vietnam conflict.
Obviously, when I was a kid, the Vietnam War was on. We used to see it on the TV, so straight away, it was in the jungle with my sailor, Action Man.
As storm clouds gather over Mrs. Rogers' garden, the Action Man gang assemble for the big parade. It's an impressive display of...
After landing in the UK, Action Man was given a makeover. Along with a bewildering display of accessories and uniforms, he also gained realistic hair, eagle eyes, and most famously of all, those gripping hands.
I was given the task to sculpt the hand, and I did it from my hand, this left hand. And that's the original sculpted model that I did. So this allowed Action Man then to grip things. He could grip his rifle, he could hold on to things when he was climbing.
But despite all the innovations, which were, quite frankly, cool, Action Man was nothing without the imagination of a child.
Some of the stories we created were as elaborate as the war movies that we watched, but we'd play all day with these things. We'd have like a day-long story that would evolve through the day.
The toy you thought deserved the number 19 spot demanded you be handy with your hands.
It only takes a pair of tiny hands to create a monster with an Airfix kit. Slightly larger hands are needed to build a tank.
I had plenty of time to play, you know, with my brother with some sticks and just running around. But sometimes you need a bit of me time, and I think Airfix is me time.
It was considered an honorary badge, really, to have constructed a model by yourself in total privacy and then to emerge, blinking into the light of day, to show it to your friends.
Initially a manufacturer of combs, Airfix moved in a new direction in 1954 when they entered the toy market. And it was in 1955 that they struck gold when the Spitfire was released. Every boy in the land was mesmerised.
The excitement of seeing the colour picture on the front. Look, the painting instructions on the back, where you stick the transfers. That's all, you know, it was too exciting for words.
Yet despite the huge variety of kits on offer, it was its range of war toys that really captured the imagination.
Airfix was brilliant. The detail of the kits, the range, very patriotic. It was all Spitfires and Churchill tanks. You get the feeling they didn't really enjoy making the German stuff as much. But they were wonderful toys, and I had millions and millions of Airfix kits. When I look sometimes at documentaries about the war, I remember thinking, I had that plane.
The memories and the associations are just too powerful. 2 weeks ago, I saw two of these flying in formation, and it was a heart-stopping moment. And this, in a way, in a ridiculous, pathetic way, as a little lump of plastic, does the same thing. It sort of, you know, one sort of trembles picking it up.
Connect Four is one of the ultimate games of strategy. It takes a mind capable of seeing four, five, even six moves ahead, an intellect that can see and set traps, an insight that discerns patterns and shapes in this swirl of blue, yellow, and red, and I'm a Connect Four Grandmaster. Nothing.
The hard part of Connect Four isn't just about getting four connected. It's about keeping a straight face and not giving your game away.
I imagine a team of geniuses worked out exactly how all of it, how it would stand up, how it would look, how it would feel, how each coin would look. Perfect.
I happen to have a PhD in educational psychology, so people would say, oh, well, educational psychology, no wonder. No, that really isn't the reason. It's more, perhaps, that I was an undiagnosed dyslexic. And I think as a dyslexic, I looked at the world a bit differently.
It's actually a really good game for your mind because you have to think, not only how am I going to, like chess, not only how am I going to win, but how do I stop them winning?
It's just about concentrating. You just need to concentrate the whole time and think about that tactics. And then the moment they stop concentrating, just for like a blink of an eye, then you make your move and you win.
When people are playing this game and you've got other people in the room, they don't have to look over anybody's shoulder to see how the game is progressing. They could sit across the room and say, hey, you made the wrong move, for crying out loud, you know.
Pretty sneaky, sis.
Connect Four, the vertical checkers game from Milton Bradley.
Next up, tickets, please. What you are witnessing here is an all-too-common scene familiar to the rail users of Great Britain. But in a scaled-down world, it's possible to get a glimpse into a fully functioning transport network with a toy desired by young boys and hit record producers alike.
The Hornby train set is harmless. It's as big as your imagination is. You can be watching the Flying Scotsman from King's Cross to Edinburgh. You can be watching the Cambrian Coast Express to North Wales.
Hornby Trains, the toy that turns boys into men and men into boys.
The great thing about Hornby Railways is that they grow on you. And the more they grow, the more fascinating the hobby becomes. Gradually, you can add track, rolling stock and accessories.
Once you've been touched by the magic of Hornby, be careful. You could end up as addicted as Pete.
There's 2,000 metres of track. There's 240 signals that all work. Ballast, there is 4,500 weight of it, all put on with a paintbrush.
In order to get seriously into Hornby, you have to be slightly odd. Once you're around 12, 13, you think, am I that odd, or do I ever want to talk to girls?
Well, this man had no problems. He got to produce Kylie and Sonia and still get to play with his trains.
It's the only toy I know that you can literally use as H.G. Wells' time machine. You can forget it. You can completely live the moment for an hour, 2 hours, and there's nothing wrong with that.
The toy you voted in at number 16 allowed children to become budding engineers. In 1901, the modern age of mechanics truly began as Frank Hornby invented a new toy called Mechanics Made Easy. It only took him another 6 years to think of a slightly more catchy name, Meccano.
He's made entirely out of Meccano. Well, it took the experts who built him 3 weeks to do it, and they used 7,000 parts.
Meccano has its roots in an era when toys were pretty much intended to be edifying and educational as much as they were fun.
Complicated and intricate toys do begin to appeal to some children at 7 or 8 years of age.
People like me who were less skilled with their hands could make very convincing swords that had lovely razor-sharp edges, and you could cut your leg open on them.
Our next game is what you might want to do to your family at Christmas.
The appeal of the game Cluedo is simply this. Murder.
And Murder was the name of the parlour game that a certain Anthony E. Pratt adopted into a board game in 1949, which we all now know as Cluedo, a game beloved of law-abiding British citizens for the last 60 years.
Who murdered Dr. Black? Find out with Cluedo. For adults and children only, the murder game from Waddington's.
In Britain, we adore murder mystery, and we like most of all safe murder mystery, what are called cozy murder mysteries. And Cluedo is the ultimate cozy murder mystery. You can be your own Miss Marple, your own Poirot. You can create the world of Agatha Christie around the board. You can commit murder with Coco on the side.
It is one of those stroke of genius games where everything about it is right. The names of the characters are intriguing. The weapons are good, The fact that it involves this house with a library and a conservatory, the sort of glamorous Agatha Christie-type house, you are there as Hercule Poirot.
With Cluedo, you can commit the act of darkness. You can kill people and enjoy it.
Our next toy is perhaps the most dominant, the most awesome, a true powerhouse of masculinity.
I had been a scrawny kid, and I knew practically every boy in the world wanted to be incredibly physically strong. I wanted to do a male action figure that was far more physically powerful than any other male action figure that had ever been designed. Suddenly, I thought of the name He-Man, and a giant bell rang in my mind. Bong! And I also gave this He-Man a grimace on his face. A grimace is this.
He-Man!
Beast Man's no match for Battle Armor He-Man.
Battle Armor He-Man with Battle Armor Skeletor.
In the 1980s, every little boy growing up wanted to be He-Man. And for some, these feelings never went away.
I am He-Man.
By the power of Grayskull, I have the power! Battle Cat!
And I became He-Man, the most powerful man in the universe.
I remember seeing some advert on TV for the toy figures, you know, Battle He-Man and the Mighty Skeletor.
Only He-Man has this power.
Oh, yeah, Battle Armor Skeletor has it too.
Now the real fun begins.
Oh, my God, Mum, I've got to have that. And that Christmas, oh, I was the luckiest boy alive.
He-Man and Skeletor sold together in the new Battle Armor pack.
The first year the line did 38.2 million. 1984, 111 million. 1985, 250 million.
And even after 25 years in the attic, he can still throw a punch. Legs have gone a little bit, but he's the man.
By the power of Grayskull, He-Man was actually Prince Adam. Who knew? A master of disguise. I must tell my two good friends, Miley Cyrus and Hannah Montana. See you after the break. Welcome back to 100 Greatest Toys. Next up at number 13, it's our second games console. But which one will it be?
Xbox should definitely be in the top 100. I tell you why. When it first came along, everyone was thinking Microsoft making a games console? Yeah, I don't think so. And it came out and it's this huge, massive black box.
I'm announcing the Xbox.
And they said, hey, we've got a console, we're going to do a console, we're going to do games. And I think it's fair to say that most people in the sort of gaming fraternity, the journalists, were not expecting anything.
Xbox straight away came out, bam, with Halo. And it's just awesome.
Every console needs a signature game, and for Xbox, it was Halo.
Oh my G.
I need a weapon.
Halo was a totally immersive experience with state-of-the-art graphics, state-of-the-art gameplay, and an added feature that was to revolutionize the gaming experience.
Playing Halo online is one of the joys in the world.
The real key to Xbox's success is the Xbox Live experience, which even today, I think, is better than what's offered from other platforms.
You go on, and it's just incredible playing with, you know, like 10, 15 other people running around, killing each other.
I just go on and suddenly I'm talking to Jim Bob in Tennessee and Jean-Francois in France, and I'm fighting them and swearing at them and talking to them, and it's amazing.
That's how I spend my evenings. I'm 37 years old.
And so the skeptics were wrong. Xbox was cool with a controversial advert and cutting-edge games, finding a new market of mature gamers, men with maybe more pocket money than sense.
The Halo franchise has made more than the Harry Potter franchise. Harry Potter is massive. Halo's made more money.
There it was, breaking these records, introducing a whole new audience to a new console. It's incredible.
At number 12, you voted for a robot with a split identity. In the 1980s, toy-making giant Hasbro bought a Japanese idea for a range of robots that could turn into cars and planes. The problem was, they weren't selling. But Hasbro knew how to get a little boy's attention.
Boys played in a specific way. There always had to be good guys, there always had to be bad guys, and there had to be a conflict between them. So we decided that all the good guys would be cars, and we called them Autobots.
Only the heroic Autobots can save Earth. Sideswipe, Grapple, Ratchet, Jazz.
And the bad guys, which were the planes at the time, would be called Decepticons.
The evil Decepticons must be stopped by the heroic Autobots.
Next, they needed a world for the Transformers to inhabit. And what better way to show this world than a cartoon?
I think it was a direct correlation between having this thing marketed to me on a Saturday morning and then pestering my mother to get me one.
They see Transformers on telly in the adverts, and they look flipping brilliant. I don't blame them for wanting them, because I look at them and think, oh, I want one of those, that's brilliant.
The marketing of Transformers laid down the standard for how to sell toys to boys.
There was a lot of criticism of television programming as being a form of advertising, but we felt it was no different than movies. Disney had been doing it for decades.
Transformers, robots in disguise. You know, it's emblazoned, it's embedded in my memory. I'll never forget it. I'll take it to my grave.
The next toy on your list didn't need any clever marketing campaign. It already had the greatest advert ever made.
The best Christmas I ever had was the day I opened a big box, and inside that box was an AT-AT walker.
Like space itself, the Star Wars craze seems endless. In fact, there are now a lot more of these galactic characters in circulation around the country than there are children.
Han Solo, and he's my favourite goodie, and he's in there.
I've got a Darth Maul cookie jar. I've got all the figures.
Before the film came out in 1977, George Lucas had waived his director fee, opting instead for a share of the profits and the toy and licensing rights. How the studio laughed until the toy shops opened.
Whatever profits the filmmakers, Lucasfilms, have made, the spin-off industry in Star Wars toys has doubled it.
It's been quite phenomenal, actually. It's been that successful that it's actually created a market of its own.
This has been one of the star performers, if I put it like that.
I've got a remote-controlled R2-D2.
I was like, give me more. I want the Red Guards who look after, you know, the Emperor, and I want the Stormtrooper, and then the snow-based Stormtrooper.
I've got the Hoth Wampa and Luke Skywalker in the box, obviously. Can't get out of the box.
Oh, and there were people at school...
There were more in the packets.
They used to buy them and then just keep them in the
packets. Yeah, basically, you just collect the packets.
Have you kept all your Star Wars stuff in good nick? And you kept all the boxes, and yes, this is coming from jealousy and bitterness, you didn't deserve to have the toys as a kid.
And as the intergalactic battle wages on in homes all over the world, there's one toy in particular that every Jedi Knight cannot be without.
Got lightsabers.
There's just no better sound in the world, is there?
And I can keep this, yeah?
My God, I'm gonna get out.
We've reached the top 10 and the toy that introduced the world to handheld consoles.
Nintendo handhelds, the Game Boy, it rules the world.
I was used to having my Donkey Kong one game, carry it around everywhere, or my Pac-Man one big game, and then suddenly you've got this little handheld thing that you could play all the games you wanted.
And the very first game, Tetris, was actually created in 1984, 5 years before Game Boy, in the Academy of Science in communist Moscow.
Clearly invented by some cuboid professor or whatever, and it was just basically a whole lot of shapes falling down, and you had to fit the shape in, and if you didn't, that was it. It was curiously addictive.
Nintendo kept releasing updates like the Game Boy Advance, Game Boy SP, and just kept making it, you know, introducing colour, making it smaller, making it flip-top, making it sexier. And they ruled the world in terms of handhelds.
Well, you say Geordie's come from Newcastle, but the answer on the card is Newcastle upon Tyne, so I'm afraid I can't let you have that one. Yes, it's Trivial Pursuit, the cause of 97% of all Christmas rows. It's such a part of family life now, but back in the 80s, when computer games were taking over the world, few had much confidence in a board game based on awarding cheese pieces for knowing the capital of Uganda. How wrong they were.
Trivial Pursuits, or is it Trivial Pursuit? I think it is Trivial Pursuits.
It was Trivial Pursuit singular, not Trivial Pursuits.
That's right, the ultimate quiz game, a Valhalla for pedants that since 1979 has been testing the knowledge of young and old on a range of subjects from sport to science.
Everything was electronic. Pac-Man and Atari were sort of the rage of the toy business, and people said if it isn't plugged in and it doesn't have batteries, it's not going to sell. And along comes this paper game that was downright Victorian.
Now then, general knowledge. Where does Trivial Pursuit come from?
My wife, being Canadian, claims everything is Canadian and everyone on telly is Canadian. But I believe that Trivial Pursuits is Canadian and is one of the few things that Canada has brought to the world.
Well, I'm afraid that's not what I've got written on the card.
Actually, it was invented in Spain, albeit by Canadians, Scott Abbott and Chris Haney.
This is a board game, which is, you couldn't get a more apt name, because basically these are games you play when you're bored, i.e. when you're with your family.
Trivial Pursuit is more than just a quiz game. The fun part is going around the board, collecting these little things.
It's a game that you get to put pies in a little circular dish, and that is satisfying on any day of the week.
Big question with Trivial Pursuit, what do you call the little triangular things?
Pies.
Is it pizza slice? Is it cheese?
I've always called them pies.
I call it cheese, but I don't know. Americans call it pizza slice.
If someone came up to me and went, hey, do you want to play Trivial Pursuit? Oh, I got a cheese. I'll go, that's cool. I'm not some sort of pie fascist.
The Canadians call them pyramids, which is just stupid.
And number eight is the toy that looks easy, but isn't. For the last 50 years, there's been one toy that's captured the sheer, gut-wrenching, white-knuckle excitement of being a motorsport hero. And it needs no introduction.
Scalextric, the next best thing to real motor racing.
Always the arguments about who had the faster car. I like the JPS car. That was the one I wanted, the black one. JPS. Nice advertising for fags back then, with the children's toys.
Well, these days there are no fag ads, but for confirmed adrenaline junkies, there's always been plenty about Scalextrics to keep them hooked right into old age.
It's amazing to look back. The fact that when I was very small, I had this exposure at a young age to motor racing through Scalextric, and that, you know, I've had this great privilege to actually go and race these big machines for real. Mostly like that.
But even seasoned professionals like Mr. former Stig still find the scaled-down speed test a challenge.
Oh, it's so tricky to try and get them round the bends, especially if you're going up full power.
Great. Whoa.
What Scalextric really needed was patience, and lots of it.
There's an inherent desire the first time you have your hands on the control to just exercise the maximum power. There was a sedate speed at which a Scalextric car would stay on the track. And once you managed to nail that, you felt like you'd genuinely achieved something.
I don't know whether it's maybe more of a bloke thing, connecting slightly electrical thing together and then doing that.
At number seven, a game for all you clever clogs.
Scrabble is the greatest word game in the history of the world, without any doubt at all. We love playing with words. That's because we know that language is power. Language is what defines us, differentiates us from the animals.
For over 80 years, Scrabble has been the world's biggest selling word game. Beloved of clever types of all ages, perhaps the cleverest of all was the man who designed the game, Alfred Butts.
The biggest genius of all is the frequency of the letters. He went through hundreds of copies of the New York Times working out how many of each letter should be put in the set. He got it absolutely spot on.
Not only were the number of letters spot on, the numbers on the letters and the board were spot on too. Add to this the unseen selection of letters and this clever game becomes more of a level playing field. However, with an estimated 200,000 words in the English language, here are a few hints to help defeat your obstinate granny.
There's some wonderful two-letter words like ZO, which is a Himalayan cattle, and XU, which is a Vietnamese coin.
Once you've mastered the two-letter words, it's time to conquer your opponent.
Conquest, which scored about 306 or something. So that's my highest scoring word. I got the Q on the double, the whole word across two triples, so the thing was multiplied by 9. And I got the 50-point bonus as well. So I got 180 points just for the Q. It's just the most brilliant game. I'm still learning it myself.
And it's a game that all sorts of people enjoy. I visited Bristol Prison once, and I saw some of the inmates playing Scrabble. And then I discovered the next day that the Queen plays Scrabble. So there you are. This is a game that is enjoyed by Her Majesty and those entertained at her pleasure. How democratic can you get? Everybody can get something out of Scrabble.
You voted another games console at number 6. It's the PlayStation.
I think it's when video games kind of grew up, really.
PlayStation made video games cool.
And how did it become cool? By hanging out with the cool kids on the side of the dance floor.
Every time you went to a nightclub in London, there were sort of PlayStation sort of setups in the corner and that kind of thing.
It became linked with young people who were out having a good time and were experiencing new things. All these kids would be playing games like Wipeout and all of these insane games and going, this is amazing.
Along with tomb-raiding Lara Croft, in 1994, Wipeout was the launch game for PlayStation, a futuristic racer with a soundtrack by top electronic dance bands like Orbital.
And it was very inspirational seeing this sort of like futuristic science fiction space race and just pulled loads of interesting sounds out of me that I wouldn't have thought about otherwise.
But unfortunately, writing music for the coolest games console on the planet comes with a downside.
We'd have had one more album if it hadn't been for the PlayStation. The amount of time I wasted on things like Resident Evil and things like that, where I should have been writing music, you know.
Now in its third incarnation, the PlayStation has sold more than 280 million units, making it the best-selling console in the world.
So that was number 6, meaning we have just 5 presents left to unwrap. Unless, of course, we find a secret one hidden at the back under the tree. But then it would probably turn out to be something rubbish, like a jumper or a scarf. See you for the top 5 final countdown after the break.
Everyone on the planet just loves Lego.
It's-a me, Mario. Woohoo! 100 greatest toys. It's-a gonna be right the back. Woohoo!
Welcome back. We've counted down from 100 and now we move on to the top 5 greatest toys of all time. Now, at number 5 is a games console and a plumber. He may well have beaten Donkey Kong, rescued Princess Peach, defeated Bowser and saved the universe, but I'm still waiting for him to come around and mend my boiler.
For over 30 years, these Japanese boffins have been creating the Nintendo games consoles, and they've become the must-have toy for millions of Britons. But it might be fair to say Nintendo would have been nothing without this guy.
Hello, it's me, Mario. Hee-hee! And a Wario. Hey, Mario.
Mario was designed by this guy, Shigeru Miyamoto, who he's just insane. He's a brilliant game designer. He kind of looks at the world as being this fun place with lots of secrets and places to hide, and he managed to transfer that into a video game.
This character, Mario, is all about fun and joy and happiness and rescuing the princess and facing life without wahoo, you know.
He's not one of these buff Aryan superheroes with bulging pecs and strange fetishized armor. He's just a plumber.
Every time a new game comes out, there's so much new invention, there's so much new fun, but the character integrity is always the same, and that's always been maintained through the 25 years. And people recognize that, and once you play one Mario game, you want to play another.
If it wasn't for Mario, Super Mario World, the Mario Brothers, Nintendo wouldn't have been what it was.
There's only 4 toys left on your countdown, so it's time to step things up.
For all you gamers out there, you don't need me to tell you that the latest must-have console has gone on sale. Some dedicated players have camped out for more than 2 nights to get their hands on the Wii.
Christmas 2006, and everyone was dying for a Wii, the first physical interactive games console that ditched the control pad and turned your living room into a gym. The boxing ring, the golf course, anything you wanted, really.
You're boxing, and the dude on the screen is boxing with you. You know, you're skiing like this, and it works. You're playing tennis.
So you don't have to sort of learn this weird secret code of, like, how to, oh, no, press X and A and B and star at the same time, and your character will do a backflip and become Prime Minister.
You don't have to adopt the kind of hypnotised geek hunch in front of the TV screen and not move.
Yes, the key selling point of the Wii, according to the manufacturers, was that it made you fit. All that jumping around, waving your arms, was just what the doctor ordered for fatties everywhere.
Don't let your kids sit around playing consoles. Give them a Wii and then you can move their arms. It's so good for them, eating a Mars bar.
OK, so it's not the answer to the country's obesity problem. What it is, unlike other consoles, is something for everyone to enjoy.
Maybe, like, Xboxes and PlayStations and things like that can be a bit of a solitary pursuit. They always market the Wii as something that groups do. People do as a family, people do as a group of friends.
And the Wii has even been used in care homes across the country as a hip replacement for the more traditional whist drives and bridge schools.
I feel like Tin Henman, yeah.
I think Arthur C. Clarke said something along the lines of that if technology is good enough, it's indistinguishable from magic. And that is what the Wii is. It's magic.
Now, that isn't magic, but your third favourite toy ever is.
In ancient times,
a game so popular that devotees started to reenact it. Its name, Dungeons & Dragons, invented in the mid-70s by a clever wizard called Gary Gygax. Before long, it spread like a great pestilence across the globe, and its band of devoted followers were mocked as geeks. And the question is, why on earth did you vote it in at number three?
Whilst it might not be very fondly remembered by the general public, the people who played it are the kind of people who now might spend a lot of their time online and therefore might be able to positively skew the results of a poll like this.
Well, that's democracy for you.
My cleric will come forward with his holy symbol in his hand and command them, in the name of all that's good and just, to return and repent their evil ways.
OK, roll 2 6-sided dice.
Don't really know what the requirements are for being a Dungeons & Dragons player. I bet there's lots of normal people, and then obviously there'll be a lot of, you know, specky, beardy types.
OK, D&D was fun. It was the one game where fantasy was king because you made it up as you went along. Players literally became someone or something else, were imbued with special powers and embarked on epic adventures. And in control of this world was the figure of the Dungeon Master. In this case, it's the guy with the handlebar moustache there.
You get a very strong sense of evil coming from...
It required one person to be the Dungeon Master. He or she created a labyrinth of rooms and passageways and populated those with monsters and magical traps and stuff. And all the other players would take on a role, a wizard, a hero, a fighter, a cleric, and go on these amazing adventures of the imagination.
And it was all about being told things. You go, right, you're in a room, OK. And there's a huge dragon with a sword, right. What are you going to do? I don't know. I'm going to kill it. What with? A sword. Right, you've attacked it with a sword, which means it's unleashed its poisoned gland and blinded you.
It has unfathomable rules, but there were rule books that you would get.
I can't believe I'm actually holding this book in my hand. This is exactly the book that used to, you know, occupy our dining room table in the 80s.
I mean, you can only be a druid here if you're half elven.
I can smell my childhood in those pages. Oh, God, I was such a geek. I can smell geek. It's nasty.
And where are they now?
So let's not be so quick to mock, because as our poll shows, D&D remains as popular as ever, with new rule books being released and still selling by the millions.
If we were here.
It was totally original. It's role-playing, it's character development, it's interacting with each other, creating a new way of playing. And for that very reason, it became a classic.
And from fantasy to cold, hard cash, it's the game where the pound note is king and the winner wins at all cost. Our penultimate toy is the board game played by everyone the world over.
Monopoly, a board game.
Monopoly is undoubtedly the greatest board game in the history of humanity. It's also a nightmare.
It's a really good model of how capitalism works, which is that you think you're going to make lots of money, for investment and property, but you're going to end up in jail.
So we start by buying a piece of London. Mayfair's always a good one. Then we build lots of houses, hotels, and everybody gives you lots and lots more money.
It's a great game, but it breaks up families. It's ruthless. It's a hard, tough game. And I thought I had a happy family, you know, a lovely son, two pretty little daughters. I actually found that I had bred a bunch of ferrets.
This land is your land, and this land is my land.
Although popularized against the backdrop of the most severe economic depression in human history, sounds familiar, it's actually a reworking of a game called The Landlord's Game, invented by a Quaker called Elizabeth McGee, to point out the evils of capitalism and land grabbing.
I like it because I've got good memories of it. It was a game that you could play with everybody, you know, all ages.
This is a game for the Michael Douglases of this world. This is a ruthless killer game for people who are interested in acquisition. It's about money. It's about achieving. It's about greed. It's about avarice. If you think it's about anything else, if you think it's about a cosy afternoon of rattling the dice and watching your little top hat going around and think, oh, what fun, let's see what the community chess has to offer, forget it. You are a loser. A loser. Get out the Scrabble set. Monopoly's not for you.
And so, what is the greatest toy in history? Well, here are some clues for you. There's barely a child in the country who hasn't built a plane or a boat or a castle with it. There can't be any parents who haven't stood on a bit and shrieked in pain. Like Simon Cowell's head, it's known around the world, is worth millions, and is completely cuboid. That's right, it's Lego.
Happiness is a bag of Lego.
I've found this marvellous way of keeping the children happy. Oh, lovely. Lego.
Everyone on the planet just loves Lego.
Yes, the toy that you have voted as number one is the greatest toy ever made. So well done, you lot, because with a fistful of Lego, anything is possible.
It's something which is limitless. It's infinite in its potential as a plaything.
It could be anything. They're just bricks.
I was one of these kids that never actually followed the box and the stuff that was on the box. I'd get a picture of a card and I'd just create a spaceship. And that is what the beauty of Lego is. You can actually create anything you want from these amazing bricks.
Originally a manufacturer of wooden toys, it produced its first bricks in 1947, and the world was changed forever.
It's a serious operation. This is a huge, great big factory that produces billions of these things every year.
20 billion to be precise, and the company reckon it's produced 400 billion over the last five decades. That's 62 Lego pieces for every man, woman and child on the planet.
Lego was like the glue for all other toys because, yeah, literally you could incorporate Lego into any other toy. So, like, for Barbie, make a house for Barbie out of Lego.
Got a Star Wars character? Haven't got the Millennium Falcon? Build one.
They can make just about anything with it. You start them with big Lego nursery bricks, which lead on to endless fun with Lego sets for children of all ages, which is ideal.
There's something about the engineer in all of us, isn't there? You know, the same sort of urge to build pyramids. That's what it is, I think. There is something really basic about that procedure that enables me to make sense of the world.
Just by sticking simple bits together, and a tiny bit of imagination, right? What is that? Nothing much at the moment, but to me and my son, turn it on its side. Dad, I've got a gun.
And that's the great thing about Lego. It is just something that lets the imagination take control.
Lego, it's a new toy every day.
So that concludes the fun that was our countdown of 100 greatest toys. I hope you've enjoyed it. You know, it's said that one day everyone must grow up and throw away such childish things, which is good news for me because I go through your bins at night and add to my collection. Thanks for watching. Take care. Good night.
Starting tomorrow, Vernon Kay begins a live Christmas family challenge to win up to £500,000. Home for the Holidays begins at 8. Next tonight on 4, Catherine Tate's Laughing at the Noughties with over a decade's worth of the good, the bad and the ugly.
Moments, memories we've been sharing.